Well, it's great to be home. I gather from the hands that went up that I'm about 50-50 on the audience or something. Those have heard me before. The plan will be the same. The subject matter will be different. In essence, we'll be looking strictly at history, but history viewed from a perspective that's different to the norm. Just to reiterate for those who weren't here before, history is not the event. History is the record of the event. History is written for all sorts of reasons. It's generally written by its winners. And as with all things, the stories of yesterday as today, we are told what we are supposed to know, and we learn it in the way that we're supposed to learn it. History may be, but it may not be, the truth. It's written for political reasons, it's written for reasons of vested interests, they may be parliamentary, they may be church interests or whatever. And to pass our exams, we have to learn and answer our questions in a certain way. Does not make it the truth. Well, it's been a year since Bloodline of the Holy Grail was published. Those of you who did hear my earlier talks will know that the book is essentially, as Greg said, about the messianic bloodline as it's descended from Jesus Christ to the present day. It was concerned and is concerned with comparing the New Testament Gospels that we know today with the original first-hand accounts of the period, whether they be the Jewish records or the Roman chronicles themselves. So this is the first lesson to learn in history, that for the most part, the people who knew more about what they were talking about were the people who were there at the time, not those that decided to interpret it a few hundred years later. It's rather like the art critic who tells us what the artist really meant to say, when actually the artist knows best. So, what we did in Bloodline and in the talks that we did earlier this year was to just look at the way that the Christian church had established itself, how it had molded itself around a certain field of vested interest, most of which was to suppress the female in the church establishment, and because the church reigned supreme for so many hundreds of years, also in society as a whole. What we find when we look at the original texts of the era is quite a different story generally from those stories that we know today. Doctrines such as Jesus was born of a virgin, that he was the one and only Son of God, such things as these do not feature at all in the documents of the era. The New Testament actually gives details of Jesus' descendant lineage from David of Israel, King David and the kings of Judah. And this has led to the one question that I've been asked more than any other in the last year, and that is, okay, this is an important bloodline. It's the bloodline from Jesus. It has a big story to tell in history of the Western world and in the Middle Eastern world. But why on earth was it so special to begin with? It cannot be special simply because it came from King David. It clearly isn't special because it came from Jesus, because before that it did come from King David. The New Testament tells us that it did. History tells us that it did. And actually, the Roman archives tell us that it did, because it was they that purloined under edict from the emperor to collect all documentation concerning the messianic line in AD 70. Most of these records are still held. They weren't destroyed as they were supposed to be. So the question is simply, what was so important about the bloodline? What made King David so important in the first place? And this is the trail that I was led on for the next book. And I'm probably about halfway through it now, as Greg said. I'm not going to start the story from the very beginning of it, because what I'm here to talk to you today is just about that one aspect of it. The Bible explains that the line that moved through the Old Testament story to King David, etc., was important because it began with Adam and Eve. first people, from whose third son, Seth, evolved a line which progressed through characters like Methuselah and Noah, down to Abraham, who became the great patriarch of the Hebrew nation. It relates that Abraham brought his family out of Mesopotamia, Iraq, into Canaan, Palestine, as we came to know it. And the descendants then moved into Egypt and stayed there for a few generations and came back to the land of Canaan again. And so the story progresses. And if we view it just as we're told it, it's in fact quite a fascinating saga. But there is nothing anywhere in it to explain to us why this line was so special. Quite the reverse is in fact the case. The ancestors are portrayed really as a sort of nomadic wandering band of territory seekers who appear to be of no real significance whatever, apart from the fact that somebody decided to write up this story. They bear no comparison to the great pharaohs of Egypt of the time. The only consolation lies in the fact that from the time of Abraham, we're told that these were God's chosen people. That's a quandary sort of situation, because according to the scriptures, the God who chose them led them through nothing but a whole succession of famines and wars and hardships. And on the face of it, the line not only doesn't look special, it doesn't actually look to have been too bright. So we're faced with a couple of possibilities here. Either David was not from this Abraham succession at all, or the story that we've been presented with is quite corrupted from the original tale. The version that we have of the story may be, just like the Christian story, adapted to suit the Jewish faith rather than to suit historical fact. So in consideration of this, I was reminded of exactly what had happened with my previous book, with the New Testament story. The Gospels that have been in the public domain for centuries bear little relation to the first-hand accounts of the period. The New Testament was concocted by the 4th century bishops to support the newly contrived Christian belief. What if the Jews had done exactly the same with the Old Testament, contrived it to suit the Jewish belief? So in this regard, it's interesting to note that although the New Testament was put together only 1600 years ago, the Old Testament, the one that tells the story from before, is actually 400 years younger than that in the form that we know it. It's based on Hebrew texts from the 10th century, just 150 years before William the Conqueror invaded England. So this is hardly first-hand accounts of anything. So I had to get back to the old writings once again, and this time we're really looking at old writings. The problem was that even if they proved to be available, the original Hebrew texts, which were rehashed centuries later in the 10th century, were themselves only written between the 6th and the 1st centuries BC. So it wasn't actually likely that even they were going to be that authentic in their telling of history from thousands of years before. The first group of books for the Old Testament was written while the Jews were held captive in the Babylon in the 6th century BC in Mesopotamia. So it was apparent that Babylon in the 6th century BC was where the records were probably held that gave the writers the information from which to put together the Old Testament. From the time of Abraham back to Adam, we have 19 generations in the Bible, and it would appear that the whole of the story of those 19 generations was all Mesopotamian. It was all Iraqi history. The interesting thing that I found was that when getting back into old Babylonian records, was that there was a great tract of southern Iraq bordering the Persian Gulf in a land that they then called Shuma, which actually in the old documents is referred to as the Eden. not the Garden of Eden, simply the Eden. And the Eden meant it in the language of the day, a pasture land, a terrain of grazing country. I found when researching for Bloodline of the Holy Grail that good sources of background information were the texts that were not selected for the New Testament. Not the ones that are, the ones that weren't. Why weren't they? What did they say that we weren't supposed to know? Perhaps I thought the same might apply to the Old Testament. Maybe the secret here is in the books that were written down at the time from the Babylonian records, but weren't ever put into print for our eyes in later times. So I looked for the books that were there, but weren't included, and it's pretty easy to find a number of them. The books of Enoch and Jubilees, for example, with which you may be quite familiar. They're currently in print. They're in the public domain. They're just not in the Bible. A further book which I'd known about for some time because I talked about it in Bloodline was the book of Jasher. Another very important book. It's so important that twice in the Old Testament our attention is drawn to the great importance of the book of Jasher. It's not there. It's very important, but they missed it out. That book is still readily available today. So there's not going to be too many big secrets there. There are a few. It tells a very good story about the time of the Israelites in Egypt and their return with Moses to the land of Canaan and that part of the story. But it tells us nothing at all of any consequence about the early line, the early, early line from Adam or from wherever we're going to go. My attention was suddenly drawn as I plowed through the Old Testament to two other books, which, in speaking to people, not many people had ever heard of before, and they didn't even know they were in the Bible. It says in the book of Numbers, "Wherefore it is said, in the book of the wars of Jehovah." Subsequently, in the book of Isaiah, we read, "Seek ye out the book of the Lord." Nobody had ever heard of these books, the book of the wars of Jehovah, the book of the Lord. What on earth were they? Do they exist? Well, in fact, remnants of them do still exist. What transpired was that on pursuing the remnants of these books, and indeed the very substance of the Babylonian and Mesopotamian records that were put together for the Old Testament, was that the answer to one question became very clear indeed. It is said and asked many, many times by many people, how on earth is it that this God of the Hebrews, who chose them to be his people, led them through trials and tribulations and floods and famines, when from time to time, with quite a contrary personality, he appears to have done some pretty nice, merciful things? There's a conflict there, a conflict of personality, which has never really been understood. Well, looking at the old records, looking at the remnants of these two books that are mentioned, we suddenly discover why they weren't included in the Old Testament, because they make it absolutely and abundantly clear that there was a distinct difference between the figures of Jehovah and the Lord. They were in fact quite separate deities. The God referred to as Jehovah turns out to be a storm god, a god of wrath, a god of vengeance. The other God, referred to throughout the original text always as the Lord, was different. He was a fertility God, a God of wisdom. So we begin to see from these texts how the different personalities are answering the question, how was he one thing on the one hand and something quite different on the other? We're dealing with two different characters here in terms of the history written down at the time. So who was the Lord? In fact, what was the word he was called by at the time that would have been turned into Lord in the English language? Well, the word in Old Hebrew was Adonai. And in the Old Text, he's also always referred to by the Hebrews as Adonai. The other God is referred to as Jehovah. The strange thing is that the name Jehovah does not appear at all. Once one begins to get back to the sort of turn of that millennium into the BC years, the further we get back, and we don't have to go too far before the name Jehovah disappears from sight altogether. And the name that we begin to see is the name that Abraham referred to the God figure in the book of Exodus or Numbers, I can't remember which one, but he calls him El Shaddai. Suddenly Jehovah has disappeared and become this other person. El Shaddai, the texts tell us, means lofty mountain, maybe lord of the mountain, ruler of the mountain, whatever the words, a mountain god. What about the name Jehovah? Where did that come from? It came, as we're told in the Bible, from a quotation. It means, I am that I am, and that was a statement meant to be said to Moses by God on the mountain. I am that I am. That was when Moses actually asked him who he was. Now that leads one to wonder, because why would Moses have asked him who he was? I mean, it would have been pretty clear that God was God, but Moses wasn't sure. He was really saying, which one have I got here? So without wishing to give the game away, he didn't really admit to too much. He just simply said, I am that I am, and anybody, one of us can say that. It means very little. Jehovah is not a name at all. The name to Abraham and the people of the time was El Shaddai. His opposer, the one that was called the Lord in the Old Text, was called Adonai. And respectively in the land of Canaan, we find identical stories coming up. They follow exactly the same pattern. They take us through the same sequence of events. They tell the same sagas. And they are called El Elyon and Baal. They mean exactly the same things. El Elyon means mountain lord, and Baal means lord. It means Adonai. Two characters still. The definitions of God and Lord as ending up in the Old Testament being mixed together throughout, as if we've got one character in this story, turn out to be totally wrong. It is a complete concoction of two quite different characters merged into one figure, hence the conflict of personalities. One was a vengeful God, a people hater. The records are very clear in this regard. The other was a social God, a people supporter. They each had wives, they each had sons and daughters. The writings tell us that throughout the patriarchal era, the Israelites endeavored to support the Adonai, the Lord. All of the early stories tell of them trying to support the Adonai, the Lord. And at every step and turn of the way, the Jehovah figure is there, the storm god, retaliating with floods and famines and tempests and destruction and just about everything that can possibly be put in the way of these people trying to follow the other guy. Even at the very last, at about 600 BC and nearer to our time than that, the Bible explains that Jerusalem was overturned by invasion, strictly at Jehovah's bidding, and Jews in their tens of thousands were taken into captivity simply because, and this is the only reason given for all of that, the Israelites had erected temples to the Lord Baal. What we have is vengeance once again. Now it's during this time of captivity, all of these decades in Babylon, as the generations lived and died and the new ones grew up, that the Jews finally decided that all of these generations of trials and torments and famine and whatever wasn't really a great scene. Maybe we should get on this guy's side. So it was then, and only then, that suddenly we discover that Jehovah is taken on board as the God, and it's at that time that it is said that he chose us to be his people. It's the other way around, actually, but that's the way we get told the story. This is only about 500 years or so before the time of Jesus Christ. So the true story of the Jews and Jehovah and the chosen people is really quite young. It doesn't go way, way back to the time of Adam and Eve, not even to the time of Abraham. They were actually following a different God. So the Jews take Jehovah on board as the main God. They decide, out of sheer fear for the peril of everything, that this is the God they're now going to follow. The Christian church then, in a vague replication of that, eventually takes on the the epitome of the same God. It doesn't call him Jehovah, it just simply calls him God, which is pretty inspirational. And it's at that time that we suddenly find that Baal and Adonai and these other names disappear. They are not being followed anymore. What we now have from that moment in time, we've now moved forward into the current common era, two faiths of fear. So where does that leave us? It leaves us knowing that within a general pantheon of gods and goddesses, of which many are named in the Bible, that there were actually two predominant male god figures who in different cultures have been called El Elyon and Baal, El Shaddai and Adonai, Mazdoa, Ahriman, Jehovah and Lord, God and Father. But what we know is that by whatever name these are called, we're dealing all the time with two different characters. One cannot mix up in the old books the name Jehovah with the name Lord. And if one now reads the Old Testament with that in mind, not the English version, but the Jewish translated version of the Old Testament, and just supplements the names each time, we suddenly find that every time something nasty happens, it is Jehovah, and every time something nice happens, it's this guy they call the Lord. It's not the same fellow. So who were they? They have all of these names, but these names all mean the same thing. One way or another, they mean ruler of the mountain or Lord. Did they actually have names? Well, to find out that, we've got to look back a little further, and again, we've got to stay in Babylonia, perhaps more generally in Mesopotamia, to follow the story back, because these same gods were followed from country to country as the Adamite family progressed. We can find the first clue in documents that were discovered not until 1929 in Syria. And these documents actually tell us that the two gods had their joint seats in the Tigris-Euphrates Valley. So we're back where we know the story should begin. We're in southern Iraq. We're in the land that was then called Shumer. What did these people call the same gods? Can we find replications of the stories so that we know we're actually talking about the same gods? And we can. We can find the stories turning up in exactly the same way with the same gods. They tell us that the god we know and got to know as Jehovah was called Ilu-Kergal. Ilu-Kergal. It means ruler of the mountain. He was also called, as a sort of abbreviated form of that, Enlil. He had a brother. And his brother had probably the most important name that we can find in the history of deity, because it's really where the whole thing began. And in English, his brother's name was Archetype. The name in those days was Enki. It means archetype. Very important word. The texts inform us that it was Enlil who brought the flood, that it was Enlil who destroyed Ur and Babylon, that it was Enlil who constantly opposed the education and enlightenment of humankind. The Syrian texts tell us that it was Enlil who obliterated the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah in later times on the Dead Sea because, it said, they were great centers of wisdom and learning. It's not what we get told, is it? We get told they were dens of debauchery. Well, in fact, one only has to look at the way the church is run today but to discover anybody who thinks something different to the dogma is running a den of debauchery. We get called heretics and all sorts of names. That happened at Sodom and Gomorrah. So it's Enki now, we discover, on the other hand, who's doing the other stuff. He, despite this wrath and vengeance of the brother figure, is granting Sumerians access to the tree of knowledge, to the tree of life. He sets up the escape strategy during the flood. He passed over the time-honored tablets of destiny, the tablets of scientific law, the bedrock of the early mystery schools. So this establishes a scene. It's somewhere for us to begin. What we know is that history isn't always history as we perceive it. we have to get back to the oldest records, and generally, it doesn't matter what century we look at, the original story written down by the people closest to the event is different and probably stands more chance of being correct. Without being a time traveler with a video recorder, we can't prove anything, but we can trust their writings better than we can trust some interpretations of the 10th century. Back then, we come to Yelm here in April this year, when I was over, and I was talking to Jay-Z about the plan for this next book, and talking about where I'd got so far with this story. And we got onto the subject of the early mystery schools, and it became very, very apparent that outside of pure historical record, that the ancient mystery schools of the region of Egypt and Mesopotamia, Canaan, probably held more of the secrets that we had to get to grips with. As far as I could determine, and I'm looking for a route to a speciality in the bloodline here, it seemed very, very apparent from everything that we could read in the text to that point, that whenever one was talking about this particular bloodline, the bloodline that came down to David and eventually to Jesus, had something rather strange and rather different about its dietary structure. There was clearly a line being built up, a line being purposely contrived for some reason or purpose, whatever. And its diet was different. There were bodily supplements being used that the words meant nothing in the text. I hadn't got a clue then what they were about. And so I was talking to Jay-Z about this, and she, with the wisdom of Mrs. Enke, said, "Fear not, because you will very soon meet the people who might have some of the answers." Well, I thought, that's pretty good. And I thought she was going to take me into the dining room and introduce me to somebody, but it wasn't quite like that. Within a week and a half of getting back to Britain, lo and behold, quite out of the blue, contact was made. And they'd never heard of Jay-Z. I'm affiliated, for those of you that don't know too much about me, to an organization called the European Council of Princes. It's a constitutional body. It comprises 33 sovereign houses, and it really operates as a sort of parliamentary buffer between dictates and what people will or will not be subjected to. I was approached simply because of that, not because of my new book, by an organization that I'd never heard of before. Considering all of my years of involvement, I'd never heard of them. And they were called the Imperial Court of the Dragon Sovereignty. The only thing that I knew about them was that they had existed a few hundred years ago, and I knew that they were centered in Hungary. What I discovered was that they were still very operative now, and they are still centered in Hungary. Their story, however, is much, much older. And this became terribly intriguing. Those of you who read books about ancient lore and mystery schools and Freemasonry and all of this sort of thing will know about the Hermetic schools, the early schools in ancient Egypt from the time of Thutmose III, where he ruled in about 1450 BC. And we know then that there were scientific academies that had apparently great secrets. What we're not told is that the mystery schools that Thutmose inherited were actually schools founded by the priests of Ra in about 2200 BC, and the senior of these mystery schools was called the Sovereign Court of the Dragon. We actually have here the oldest single scientific mystery school in the world. What were the earliest aims and ambitions of the order? See here, they said, this is what we were set up to do, and this comes from 2000 BC, to perpetuate and advance the scientific strength of the royal family. Now, we're looking here apparently at the royal family in Egypt, but once one gets into the genealogy, we can find that same family was the family that were the great kings in Iraq earlier. The picture begins to emerge. Yeah, there's something special here. There's something so special here that they set up royal courts and orders to look after the formulation of this family. Nothing is said to me then about diets or bodily supplements or the things I'd learned from Iraq. But the thing is beginning to merge into a picture. Suddenly, this line is so important that for 2,000 years after Christ and for 2,000 years before Christ, for 4,000 years, this same order has been operative and its aims and functions are the same today as they were then, to support and perpetuate the royal bloodline. The kings of the early succession, the kings who became the pharaohs of Egypt, and the kings of Israel, the high kings of Judah, were originally the kings of Mesopotamia. We then look for traditions and we find that the anointing ceremonies were identical. The kings, upon coronation, were anointed with the fat of the sacred dragon, the crocodile, referred to in Egypt as the holy Messer, from which derived the Hebrew word to anoint. And the early kings of the period were called always dragons or messers, messiahs. That's where Messiah comes from. It comes from the ancient holy crocodile. So when one talks about Jesus the Messiah, we actually have an anomaly there, because he's not the Messiah, he's one of a whole succession of messiahs, and these are pretty important people who are being looked after by a court of high priests, people looking after the bloodline. In times of battle, we're told, when different kingdoms are brought together to form an overall army, they're appointed a head dragon, a head messiah, the King of Kings, and the name in Celtic terms became Pendragon. So we're beginning to see the names creeping in here of all the stuff we know about in Arthurian lore, Uther Pendragon and the royal kingdoms. This started way, way back. We're suddenly into 2000 BC. We're now going to move back into 3000 and 4000 BC, and we find these same titles being used, dragons, messiahs, all the time. One of the things I learned from the order was actually the root of the word kingship. Not many of us think about it, do we? Kings are kings and queens are queens, and it doesn't mean a lot, that's what they are. The name goes back to the very, very earliest times. The records show that the central G in the word kingship, or the G on the end of king, is just the latter-day Western edition for the sake of making it easier to say and to differentiate it from another word, because the word kingship is absolutely identical with the word kinship. It means blood relative. A king is a blood relative, and that's all it means. In its original form, however, it's spelt differently. We haven't got kinship or kingship, we have kainship. And the first king of the dragon messianic succession is recorded in the documents of the order from 2200 BC to be the fellow that we know as the biblical Cain. Well, he's not actually too important in the story, is he, apart from killing his brother Abel and disappearing from sight? He turns out to be the founder of the greatest sovereign line in history. We can now begin to see the anomaly in the book of Genesis. The line from Seth, the third son of Adam and Eve, turns out not to be the important person in this succession at all. The important person is the guy that gets shunned and pushed aside, the first son of Eve, whose name, we're told, is Cain. In fact, the records tell us that he was the Cain, the king. He was the first earthly high king of an area called Kish, which sits pretty near Babylon in Iraq. So two more things then suddenly come to look. The more you start looking now, the more begins to leap out from pages, just as it did with the New Testament stuff. Because the stories that we know, that we're taught from our schoolrooms and our pulpits, tell us about Cain and Abel, the two sons of Adam and Eve, and Cain slew Abel. Actually, when you look at the Bible and all the other texts of the period, they are not two sons of Adam and Eve at all. They are both sons of Eve. But only Abel turns out to be a son of Adam. Even the book of Genesis explains to us that Eve said, I have gotten me a man from the Lord. Who was the Lord? The Lord was Enki. If we now begin to look at old Jewish literature again, we discover that there is nothing outside of our pulpit teaching that tells us that Adam was the father of Cain. We suddenly learn that Enki was the father of Cain. We have a situation that begins to repeat the Jesus type of experience. We actually have an original son of a God. We can then look at the other jargon of the era, the way that the story gets told to us. We're told that Cain was a tiller of the ground. Did the original text say that? Do they say he was a tiller of the ground? Well, not quite. What they actually say is that Cain had dominion over the earth. Well, it's not quite the same, is it? Can see how it gets translated to be something different, though. In fact, the Bible translators seem to have continually had a problem in translating the effective word for earth. They translated it to ground, to clay, to soil, to dust, and to all sorts of things, except what they should have translated it to was the earth. The earth, not that earth, the earth. Every time the word is mentioned to be translatable, they're referring to the earth. Even in the case of Adam and Eve, the translators get it wrong. The Bible says, male and female, he created them and he called their name Adam. The older records use the term Adamah, which means of earth. It did not mean they were made of dirt or clay or dust. It says, exactly as the Anchor Hebrew Bible now explains clearly for us all to understand, they were of the earth, they were earthlings. So we're suddenly discovering there's a bit of a difference here now between the gods and the earthlings. And we know that earthlings, if something is called that, it's not quite like the average person, because there's lots of other people around at the time. They're not called earthlings. So there's a difference. Here are people who for some reason or another are not gods, but they're not just ordinary evolving people. They're earthlings. There is a hell of a lot, and people here have probably read authors like Zechariah Sitchin and others. There's been a lot written about the sort of genetic engineering that went on at that time, about how characters of the era that may have ended up being called Adam and Eve or whatever were clinically cloned in some regard. I'm not actually going to dwell on that tonight. It's a part of my book, and I actually go much more fully into it than Sitchin and others. What I really want to do is to cut to the chase here and get onto the story of the bloodline. So we need to take that as read, that the Adam-Eve figures were the first of something. We know that they were the first of something. Everything tells us it was. And the Sumerian records themselves tell us that they were the first of something which they call the branches. And the word branches, the word for branches was clones. Spelt just like it is today, it means branches. So Adam's not the first man on earth, he's the first of a specifically devised strain of being, and his surrogate mother is actually named in the records of Iraq, and she's called Ninkursag. It means lady of life, lady of the embryo. She was the surrogate mother of Adam, and we find Adam actually recorded by the name Adam, Adama, Ataba, various forms of the name, as the very, very first king before Cain of this country called Kish. So we find that the bloodline is now beginning to have a little more significance. They're not just wandering nomads picking fruit out of the trees and things. We're building up a kingly line here right from the start. It was because of Ninkursag's title, the Lady of Life, that Eve, or Ava as the records call her at the time, was subsequently given exactly the same name by the Hebrews, Lady of Life. It's said in the text that Eve actually means life. So that's where the title comes from. It comes from the goddess who was the Lady of Life. But there's something actually rather more strange here, because Eve's always called the Lady of the Rib as well. We get told how Adam's rib was pulled from his side and she was made from this rib. Well, that's an odd one, because Lady of Life in Sumerian, the word for Lady of Life was ninti. There was another word pronounced T, a longer word than T, and that meant rib. And the Hebrews actually didn't seem to understand the difference between the two. So ninti and ninti became the same thing, and she became the Lady of the Rib, and it was really that simple. There's nothing else in the records to tell us anything about Adam's side and ribs and all of this sort of stuff. Lady of the Rib, ninti, mistranslation for Lady of Life. So we now have Enki, and we now have Enlil, and we suddenly discover that this Ninkursag woman, this goddess, this Lady of Life, is their sister. And they're both married to the same sister. It is the rule of matriarchal kingship as applied at the time, the same rule that subsequently got made the rule on earth. Kings married their first, second sisters or first or second cousins. And it seems to suddenly become apparent that this is being done to perpetuate something quite specific in the bloodline. Those who have read books about ancient Sumer and the gods of the time will know that the great pantheon of the era were called the Anunnaki. These were the gods of the time. In Canaan, they called them Elohim. In fact, the court of the Elohim, the court of the Anunnaki, the Grand Assembly, as it was called in those days, is actually mentioned in the Bible. If we look at Psalm 82, we discover Jehovah actually making an appearance at this court before the other gods and trying to claim supremacy. So even the Bible tells us that he wasn't the only one. Cain was important, we discover, because he's actually the son, not of Adam and Eve, but of Enki and Eve. We actually have here, if we use the word that they used, the word clone, or clone, the branch, we have a second stage in the cloning fertilization process. We have now not only a partly contrived Eve, who is 50% Anunnaki, we now have Eve and Enki, who is wholly Anunnaki, and a son that turns out, according to the records, to be at least three-quarters Anunnaki. We have a man who's very much approaching a god figure himself. The records actually say that Cain's blood was so advanced that his brother Hevel, the brother's Hevel, Abel, we know him, his brother Hevel's blood was earthbound by comparison. That's what the records say. His blood was so advanced that his brother's blood was earthbound. What does our Bible say? Cain rose up against Abel and spilled his blood on the ground. It actually comes from a translation of rose up. Cain rose so high above Abel, we're told. So we get told he rose up against him and spilled his blood on the ground. That is not what the records say at all. There is no story anywhere outside of our Bible teaching that indicates that whatsoever. So we're moving into sovereign history. We have a bloodline which has been contrived. It's being contrived for leadership among men in a very special way. The gods of the time are actually trying to implant whatever it is they have that's so special into this nuclear race here. The leaders, the new leaders, the Cains, the kings, the kin. So we can now progress our story to what now becomes, and this is something in the records of the Dragon Court, the very, very first grant of royal arms, heraldry, in sovereign history. The grant of arms, which denoted the messianic bloodline for all time, today as then. The Sumerians refer to this insignia as the Gra'al. Gra'al. Familiar, isn't it? Grail, when you put it together. The Holy Grail. The Bible calls it the Mark of Cain. The mark is portrayed to us by the church as if it was some sort of a curse. The Lord thrust the mark upon Cain. But why did he do it? It says he did it to save him being killed by his enemies. At that moment in time, we're supposed to believe that Cain's killed Abel, And apart from his mother, there's nobody else on earth anyway, but now he has a mark to protect him from his enemies. What enemies? Well, in fact, we know that Cain got into an argument with Jehovah, this is the way the story goes, over allegiance problems, venerations. There was a dispute about who should offer veneration to Jehovah and who shouldn't. It was not Cain's prerogative to offer veneration to Jehovah because he was the son of Jehovah's brother. It then tells us that the Lord placed a mark upon Cain to save him from his enemies, a sevenfold vengeance. But who was the Lord? The Lord was not Jehovah. The Lord was his brother, Enki. So we find, in fact, what the dragon caught has recorded for all time, something called the first grant of arms in sovereign history, when Lord Enki grants to his son the Grail, the mark of Cain. What is the mark of Cain? It is the most simplest of all sovereign devices. It is very simply, and the Phoenician records tell us this, the early Hebrew records tell us this, the Mesopotamian records tell us this, and they all tell us the same symbol. It is very simply an upright red cross within a circle. A very familiar image. A red cross in a circle. It's called the Grail. Why was it called the Grail? Because we know the Grail to be something else. A Grail is a chalice, or a Grail is a bloodline, or whatever we spoke about in our previous talks. Well, it's rather odd, because this emblem, although it's a cross within a circle, is defined as the dew cup. The dew cup. The cup of the waters. This is rather interesting, because when one gets into Grail lore of medieval times, we always have ladies of the waters, ladies of the fountain, things like water's terribly important here in this early sovereign history. The mark of Cain is the dew cup, the cup of the waters, which in the sort of Greco-Roman language of early times was called Rosi Crucis. Rosi dew, Crucis cup, Rosi Crucis, from whence comes Rosicrucians. The dew cup, the Grail. An upright red cross. Even today, the dragon court uses the same emblem. It's a little more advanced, it's a little more pretty, but it's the identical emblem to what they had then. So Cain is now king. Cain has a grant of arms. What do we do to perpetuate his bloodline? What do we do to make his heirs and successors even more special? We now have to marry him back into the godly line. He marries a woman, the records tell us, called Lulava. The Bible doesn't give us this name. It tells us about his offspring, but it doesn't give us her name. Other records do. Lulava. It names their son in the Bible, Enoch. Other records name his other son, Atun. The Sumerian records tell us that Atun was the successor of Cain. That's the reason why he's not mentioned in the Bible. Only Enoch is. Atun was the successor. Atun as Etana was the next high king of Kish. So we're now beginning not only a royal bloodline, we're actually beginning to see the very first kingly dynasty on earth. Kings, earthlings, Adamas, highly bred people meant to be leaders among humankind. We keep seeing them referred to as the fruit and the branches of the vine. In latter-day times, the Holy Grail is often referred to as a vine of grapes. The word keeps coming up. These people are Cains, these people are clones. Now, today we use the clone in quite a different form, but it almost means the same thing, specially contrived to be of a kind. K-L-O-N-E in the old spelling. So by virtue of this contrived breeding, what we have is a specifically modeled succession beginning to build up in history. A succession which, judging by their military prowess, judging by their political influence, judging by their leadership at the great assemblies, seem to have a much more heightened awareness than the norm. In terms of culture and wisdom and general intuition, there is no doubt that these people were advanced. His blood was so advanced that he rose above his brother. This seems to be the story throughout the generations. The senior people in this line are really beginning to look quite special. And this is the line that is finally going to end up with King David and eventually with Jesus. It was recognized at the time, however, that there was more to it than just producing a line and dealing with its diet and its general health. What they do seem to know about, and they make a very big thing of it, they don't call it the same thing, but it would be what we call today DNA. And they record very, very specifically that the important gene that moves through this from generation to generation is strictly a female gene. The DNA structure that gives the ability for true kingship comes through the mother, always. The best that latter-day Judaism managed to do to hang on to this tradition was to claim that being a Jew was something that happened because of your mother. It doesn't matter too much about your father. If your mother's a Jew, you're a Jew. This was set up in the kingly line. If the mother had to be part of the great queenly succession for the son to succeed as a king. So at whatever stage the king was, whether it was Cain or whether it was his son Atun or whoever following that, they were always married back into a princessly line that was pretty well strictly and wholly Anunnaki. Not Adamas and Earthlings at all, but straight back into the godly race. So in fact, every time the line got stronger and stronger and stronger. True kingship, it was maintained. True Cainship was inherited through the mother. So we can now begin to see why it was that, just like with the New Testament, history gets contrived in a different way, because just like the Roman Church, as we talked about in our previous discussion, just like the Roman Church built up a religion based on a vested interest that was to keep women out of positions of authority in society and the church, the Jews had earlier done exactly the same thing. They had built up a male-dominated religion, and they had lost all trace of this real importance of the kingly heritage coming through the women from the early days. We discover, getting back to my original findings about the possibility of something dietary going on here, from this point, from the time of Cain's son Etana, we suddenly discover the mention of something called the plant of life. These people are being fed from the plant of life. It's from the plant of life that this word branches and vine keeps getting mentioned, from which we get the clones. The plant of life is the root of this. This is going to turn out to be the key of what was special about the bloodline. Why was it then that the Jews decided to knock that on the head and to forget it and to tell us a tale about wandering, territory-seeking nomads, when what they had to tell was the greatest story in the whole of history, being born as earthlings from the gods? We're told that the line came from Seth, the line came down to Noah, the line came down to Abraham. What happened, I wonder, I did wonder along the way, what happened to change the course of events? What happened in Jewish law or in Jewish custom to make them have to knock this early part of history on their head? There had to be a reason for it. They wouldn't have done it to get rid of something important. They would have done it to get rid of something that was a problem to them. Something must have happened. Maybe something happened around about the time of Noah. It's actually quite surprising how often, when you come up with an idea like that, and you think, this is the era we're looking at. We're looking at the era of Noah. So what happened then to make them make this change? Was there something? Is there something in the Bible? And we actually find that there is. What happened was that at the time of Noah, Jehovah, who they've taken on board to worship wholly and solely some centuries later, apparently said to the sons of Noah, "The lifeblood of the flesh thereof ye shall not eat." The blood ye shall not eat. This edict becomes expressly important to later Jewish law and the Jewish way of life. Why does Jehovah suddenly at that moment in time become obsessed with what to us seems like the intake of blood in some form or another? What's the problem here? It's a customary Jewish practice now to hang meat for bloodletting before consuming it and cooking it. What's odd is that in the Christian religion, something quite different happens. In the Christian religion, in contrast, it's actually customary to take what we know as the Mass or the Communion Sacrament, which takes us through a ritual of pretending to be drinking blood. We drink blood from a chalice. Why a chalice? This is Grail law coming into play. This is the old cup of the Jew, holy waters. Jews cannot and will not eat blood if they're observing the faith. The Christians pretend to. The blood of the Messianic line. This is my blood, the blood of Jesus, and drinking wine. So could it be, one wonders, that this Christian tradition has actually got more right than the Jewish tradition in terms of old law? Maybe the Christian tradition of pretending to drink blood is a throwback, a real throwback to some really ancient custom before the days of Noah. Could that be? Well, as it turns out, it is. It is exactly that. The other interesting thing is that we discover that every time what we might think of as blood drinking or blood eating is referred to in the early days, in the dietary stories, the sign that always gets presented to us is the red cross in the circle. Now, crosses in circles mean a lot of things, but red crosses in the circle are always tied up with this particular ritual, the dew cup, the cup of the waters, the Rosicrucius. However, it's always a cup, it's always a chalice that's involved. And from Bloodline of the Holy Grail, what we learned with our investigations was that the chalice was the ultimate symbol of the female. One can go back to 3,500, 4,000 BC and find the female symbol is a cup or a chalice. In its simplest form, it is simply this circle with the red cross in it. Could it be that this blood that we're talking about, that was suddenly such a problem, but is linked to the fact that kingship is only obtainable through the gene of the female, has something to do with menstrual blood? Is this the important factor here? Well, that's a bit hard to take when you think about it first off, but the more you look, the more you find, and you only have to look at the Dragon Court records from 2200 BC and you find, yes, this is exactly what we're looking at. We're looking at early stages of bodily supplements. We're looking at stages before the drug companies came in. We're looking at times before alchemy and early laboratories and things like that. We're simply looking at things could be done with natural products. We begin to find an old ritual in Egypt, in Canaan, in Babylonia, in Mesopotamia, generally in Akkad and down into Shumer, same ritual. It's called the ritual of the starfire. Starfire. It's the ritual which we're told began with Enki's sister Ninhursag. Ninhursag was the lady of the embryo, the lady of life, the lady who we are told fed her offspring with her starfire. We're looking at a ritual of menstrual blood. This is stunning stuff because it seems a little unsavory, doesn't it, to start with? I started to ask a few friends of mine and people that I knew who were doctors and scientists and people with drug companies, and I said, can you tell me what some of these medicines that we take today are made of? Can you actually tell me what the ingredients are, for example, for this or for this or for this? And they told me a few of these things, and suddenly starfire seemed a pretty good bet. It was not so frightening after all. We actually are in the habit of taking some very, very strange stuff without knowing it because it looks like a little white pill. The divine starfire. Suddenly, the more you look for it, the more you find it. And every time you find it, you find the circle with the red cross, the cup of the dew, the cup of the holy waters, the cup that overflows. You keep finding as well the importance of the female line. We find all sorts of strange words being used, but all the time we're talking about genes, genetic construction, DNA. They tell us that Ninkursag, the Lady of Life, was also known in Egypt as Isis. Isis, the great mother, the model for the Virgin Mother with the child, her child Horus. Isis is the great mother. Isis is the woman of the gene. Isis is Ninkursag. Isis is the lady of gene. Isis, Genesis. The Greeks called it Genesis. It was originally a split word. And in the earliest versions of the Septuagint that I can find, it is gene Isis. The word for in the beginning in Jewish was quite different. The Bible begins with it. It's not Genesis. Quite a different word. So before looking at this star for our practice in detail, which we shall, we must now remind ourselves that actually it was Jehovah Enlil who gave the instruction that blood must not be taken, and he gave it to Noah and the sons of Noah, members of this kingly line. It was Jehovah that gave this edict. It was not his brother Enki who had fathered this line. It would appear that for a good while they actually didn't take too much notice at all. If Jehovah didn't like it, Jehovah could bring a flood or something, but they didn't actually have to obey. It wasn't until much later that they decided to obey this guy all the time. The starfire practice seemed to continue for quite a long time, and it is this that begins to make the line important. Noah, Abraham and the others, these were all products of clone and starfire. Kings of very, very high repute in a line, not from Seth, but from Cain. Why now we can understand, did we have a contrived line from Seth and not the line from Cain? Because by contriving a line from Seth down to Noah, we got rid of it being Cainship, starfireship. We knocked it out of the ball game completely because all of a sudden we weren't taking blood. But if this was an edict from Jehovah, then probably it actually wasn't to their benefit. Starfire was called the great lunar essence of the goddess. Actually, even in everyday mundane environments, I've discovered now this starfire stuff is pretty potent. I decided to have, again, friends of mine at the hospital tell me what was really here. Is this important stuff? They said, if it was food, it is the most potent life force on Earth. And clearly we know that because it happens because of bringing life onto Earth. Producers of starfire, the goddesses who held themselves in position for this particular function for the kingly line, were designated the flowers. Flowers. Which actually was written flowers. It is exactly where our word flower comes from. The flower was the flower, and the flower was always the lily, and the lily was the key to the name of just about everybody in that line. A version or a variation of Lily, just like Lulava was the wife of Cain. Lulava, again from a base of Lily. From Lily we have Lulava, we have Lilith, we have Lilutu, we have Lilette. What actually, I asked my doctor friends, is really so special about starfire. What is so special about this food that if not used ends up being menstrual blood? It holds, they said, the greatest of all bodily secretions from certain glands, from the pineal gland, from the pituitary gland, certain parts of our brain function that give us specific levels of awareness and intellect. All of the things that the kingly line needed. What was actually happening was that instead of them relying solely on their own glandular production of secretions and hormones, they were being fed with enhancements for this, just like we take hormone replacement therapy and other bodily supplements today. But they were taking it at a very, very advanced level, because this is not earthly stuff, this is Anunnaki starfire, straight from the goddesses. What we suddenly find is that because of the impact that this has on glands like the pineal, we're not only feeding the body more substances like melatonin and serotonin, we're actually causing the glands within those kingly people themselves to begin to produce more of these hormones. They are punching this stuff out like crazy, and they are living for very, very long times. All of a sudden, the great ages of this patriarchal line in the Bible begin not to look so strange after all. Because when one looks at the historical record of exactly the same family, these same numbers of years keep appearing. They lived for hundreds of years. And it was said that this was exactly because of this practice. Well, it's no secret really, actually, it hadn't occurred to me before. But when one studies the importance of glands like the pineal and melatonin production, even today, we know that there are within these secretions keys to anti-aging. They have anti-aging properties. Well, they were actually using this, and they were making really good use of it. And they were making sure that their kings lived for a very, very long time. The interesting thing is that once one steps outside of this line and looks at parallel families, these ages aren't there at all. These ages are as normal as anybody else's. The great ages in the line continued way past Noah for a few generations. And not until we get to the time of Abraham and beyond do suddenly the life patterns begin to change in the line. The ages begin to become more normal. Isaac lived for 110 years and we're gradually coming down the tree, and soon we're into people living 70 years and 80 years and pretty ordinary sort of lifespans. So what we can judge by this is that we have actually hit it on the head, that it's around Abraham's time, not Noah's time, that they began to take notice of thou shalt not take the lifeblood. They were beginning to pull off of it. So we have a situation, we have a line now coming down, and it supposedly goes from Abraham down to David, but actually it's ceasing to become very special. So why is it still special when it gets to David? Well, perhaps it went somewhere else and came back, and it actually did. Because it transpires that from exactly that strain from Noah before the time of Abraham, the line had already branched out, and the line had already become the early kingdoms and pharaohs of Egypt. And when one looks at their lifespans again, they seem to go on for a very, very long time. In fact, some of them go on for so long that there are no records of deaths and certainly no evidence of any tombs. Goodness knows what happened to them. It simply disappeared. Flowers and flowers. The plant of life, the flower, it was said, was a lily who gave us the nectar of supreme excellence, which the Greeks called later soma. Soma is related to life, to longevity. So why dragons? We know that the Messiah was a dragon. We know that the crocodile was the root of dragon. We know that the dragon order was founded in 2200 BC. We know that the word dragons and pendragons actually comes from way back about 3800 BC. Why isn't the symbol a dragon? Why is the symbol this red cross? Well, in actual fact, one discovers that the symbol is a dragon. The red cross, the dew cup, is a dragon. The circle, it transpires, is a serpent clutching its own tail, creating everlasting, the unity. So suddenly, the dragon is linked with the dew cup, is linked with the Holy Grail, and it's why the Grail kings were still called in the Middle Ages Pendragons. The symbol was the same, and as one progresses through history and follows the Red Cross symbol, it gradually emerges that this is actually a dragon, and it's more pictorially displayed, but it was always that. It was always a dragon, and the dragon was called Draco, Draco the dragon. It was the emblem of the pharaohs, the dragon. It was the emblem of the Egyptian Therapeutate at Qumran in the time of Jesus. It was the Bestia Neptunis, the great sea serpent of the Merovingian Fisher Kings in France. And it is the emblem of most of the royal families today, somewhere on their coats of arms, the dragon, Draco. Draco is identical as a dragon with serpent, because there's little relation between these fire-breathing winged dragons that we see in nursery rhyme. The dragon was originally more like a crocodile. It was a four-legged, rather large, snouted serpent. Serpent and dragon were absolutely identical, and it didn't really matter which word was used, it meant the same thing. The dragon, the holy crocodile, the messer, the messiah. The word serpent is used many, many times in the Bible. Starts off with the story of Adam and Eve and the serpent in the garden. Dragon in the garden. Every time we see the word serpent in the Bible, when we look back at the original Hebrew writings to see what it was translated from, it was translated from a word that with vowels in it comes to something like Nahash. N-H-S-H, consonantally. The word meant to decipher. It meant to divine. It meant to find out. It had nothing whatever to do with snakes. The dragon was always he who held the knowledge, he who from one found out, he whom could divine, and that is the root of why we call gods and deities divine, because they held the roots of the serpent, of the Nahash, to the divining. They had the knowledge, they had the knowing, they were the kings, and the serpent of the garden, we are told, was Enki. Serpents, from that time on until today, are always, always associated with wisdom and with knowledge. They're not evil. They've never been evil in any law except Christian and Latter-day Jewish law. They were wisdom. They were healing. They were knowledge. It's interesting to discover, once one starts to look, how often serpents and dragons appear in motifs of healing institutions today. The American Medical Association is actually the plant of life, a tree staff with a winding serpent around it. Once one looks a little further into that, it's more interesting to see that there are more complex medical devices using serpents. The one that we actually know perhaps is the winged caduceus of Hermes with the two coiling serpents around it. This actually is not just the emblem of medical associations worldwide today. It was actually one of the earliest symbols of the early dragon court. It was the emblem of the Essene Therapeutate at Qumran at the time of Jesus, and the records tell us exactly what it is. The theory that this is a winged caduceus is a myth. It has very little to do with Hermes or with Mercury. The records tell us that the staff that stands centrally is the spinal column. The nervous system are the coiling serpents that go around it. The two wings at the top are the ventricles of the brain, left and right, and that little spot in between is the pineal gland. The gland, the wings, the top of the stem are referred to in the oldest of law and even certain yogis and people use the term today, it's called the swan. This was the order of the swan that great Grail knights such as Lohengrin and Parsifal belongs to, and it is still a flourishing knightly order today. It is a knightly order for those who are still partaking of the equivalent, in today's terms, of starfire. I don't have to tell you too much, I suppose, about pineal glands and things like that, but for the benefit of a few who might not have read too much, the gland is small, it's tiny, it sits between the two left and right sides of the brain. It doesn't form part of the brain matter, but it's part of it, it's central. It sits in the back and it's sort of in the middle here and looks straight through the front. It's called the third eye sometimes. What it does is to produce the hormone, the secretion that gives many of the qualities that were actually purposely fed back into this bloodline. Melatonin and the pituitary gland produces serotonin, all important for longevity, all important for intuition, important for awareness, important for just about every aspect of supreme and superior leadership. They were called, even then, people of the swan. They were also serpents, they were also dragons, they were also kings of the Graal, Grail, Dew Cup. And it's why this mythology creeps on even to the modern times. We can get into the Middle Ages, we can get into Arthurian lore all the time. We have chalices, we have ladies of the fountain, ladies of the flow, ladies of the waters. We have dragons, we have pendragons. All of these names crop up, and these names exist in one form or another going back for 5,000 years. In the days of ancient Sumer, we can find records, and there are tens of thousands of records from that era now available that have been translated in the last 50 years, that actually explain that the priests of Anu, who was the father of Enki and Enlil, the priests of Anu perfected and elaborated a ramifying medical science of living substances. And it tells us that the most important of these for the treatment of just about anything was menstrual starfire from the Anunnaki goddess. They called it the gold of the gods. It was used as medicine, but it was fed daily and regularly to the kings of the succession. In Egypt and Mediterranean in later times, we discover that the ritual progresses. This is beyond the days of Anunnaki now. Starfire becomes a priestly activity. There are bred for the purpose within the temples, virgin priestesses who exist only for the purpose of producing the starfire. And they are called scarlet women. They are granted always the names of Lily, Lilutu, and Lilette, and the other names. These are their temple names, just as they used to be in ancient Sumer, but we are now earthly priestesses, very highly bred, specifically for the purpose. The red of the cross now becomes given a name, and the red of the cross is called Ritu. It's actually not an Egyptian name, it was an Asian name, but it was called Ritu. Ritu was the gold of the gods. Ritu is the word from which we actually get red and ritual, and indeed root. And red, Ritu, was defined as red gold of the golden starfire. So suddenly we begin to get something new happening here. We're beginning to get the words red and gold tied up together. They don't mean the same thing at all, but red is now gold, and gold is now red, and the red is the gold of the gods, and the Ritu practice becomes the ritual. Once one moves into this realm of learning that ritual comes from the collecting of the Ritu, the starfire, you begin to find a whole sequence of events that lead to many of the words that we have today. One of the first things that we see is that red also is synonymous with black. I'm not quite sure why, but whenever black is mentioned, it means the same as red, and whenever red is mentioned, it means the same as black. Even in India, the goddess Kali was said to be both red and black, and still is in various traditions. Now, Kali Math, who was the original model for the Indian goddess Kali, Kali Math was the sister of Lulava, the wife of Cain. Kali Math was strictly Anunnaki. And Kali Math, we are told, was black. Kali Math, we are told, was red. Kali Math, we are told, was a scarlet woman. And Kali Math becomes, not too strangely, Kali, the goddess of times and seasons and periods and cycles. In the early days, therefore, we're looking at something that is going to evolve into a specific area of what we later became to call alchemy. It's not the whole of alchemy, it's a little part of it. But we can now see where it's going. We can now see that we're dealing with a natural substance that eventually has to become a purposely contrived drug, for want of a better word, something else. Because actually, this Anunnaki star fire is not going to be around forever, which it wasn't. What does star fire do? It produces hormonal secretions. Who were the people that knew about these secretions? They were the people who knew these secretions. It's where the word secret comes from. It comes from the early priests, the temples of the dragon court, who kept the secret, the secretions. And this was one of the key secrets, really, of the early mystery schools, was the upholding of the starfire ritual. It is one of the secrets that Freemasonry says have been lost. They know that there's a secret somewhere back in ancient Egypt and Sumeria, but they're not quite sure what it is. Well, this is one of the secrets. The secret of the secretion, of the ritual, of the ritual. Are there any other words, we wonder? There actually are. In fact, there's no end to them. Once you start looking, we can suddenly find that this English language of ours that we thought came from bits of Latin and bits of Greek, of course, does. But where did they come from? They came from ancient Egypt and ancient Sumer and all of these other countries, and the words keep piling in, not just ritual and secret, but other words as well. Coal. Coal is black. Coal comes from Bath Coal. Who was Bath Coal? Bath Coal was what the Jews called Kali. Kali, coal, coal, black. The women who were the scarlet women, the priestesses, were said to be the women of the voice. They were actually producing the wisdom of tomorrow. They had the voice. They produced the starfire. The womb was therefore the utterer of the word, the utterer, the uterus. It goes on and on. In fact, you wouldn't believe how many words come out of this stuff. Scarlet women. We all know what they are, don't we? Or at least we thought we did until just now. The Greeks called the scarlet women, these great priestesses of the starfire, Hierodulae, which actually got sort of shortened via medieval French into English to the word harlot. The Germans, old Germanic languages from Saxony and other countries, had a word hores, H-O-R-E-S in modern terms, which actually was anglicized to whores. Scarlet women, hierodulae, whores, harlots, whatever, all the same things, And every one of those words, whores, harodule, whatever, translates back to the same thing, dearly beloved one. There is no connection whatever. And really, the good dictionaries still tell us this if we care to look. There is no, not even the slightest vestige of similarity between the word whore and harlot and, say, prostitute or adulteress. They are not linked in any way. All words tell us what they mean, and those words mean dear beloved one. Scarlet women, sacred priestesses of the starfire. So when did it go? When did we suddenly forget all this stuff? Why was it so important? Why did we suddenly just have people who bled their meat and weren't of much consequence, really, until later days? It actually happened when the Latter-day descendants, whether in the Jewish tradition or in the later Christian tradition, decided to actually start forging history. Not just translating it, but interpreting it to suit a vested interest of the moment. The one thing in the Jewish faith, as in the Christian faith, that was absolutely predominant was that any importance played by the female had to go. Not on. This is male stuff now. Priests, that's what we are. So it gets lost. Not because it necessarily has to, but because suddenly history has become religion. Not just religion, but a faith of fear. A religion based on venerating a guy who will bring floods and famines and destruction if you don't do as you're told. Or so they thought. The Rosicrucius, the Jew cup, the mark of the later Rosicrucians, is all based on starfire ritual. It is why the Christian church, without knowing it, takes us through a ceremony that it doesn't understand when we pretend to drink blood from the chalice. It had all sorts of names. It was nectar of the gods. It was gold of the gods. It was also called the ceremony of the light. Now we're moving into areas that we begin to understand here, the ways of the light. Following the light, we suddenly look at the Essene records and the records from the Dead Sea Scrolls and whatever, and suddenly we're into a whole new scheme of operations which is pursuing the roots of the light. The light, when we look at back at the old records, actually was the starfire. The starfire is about the acquisition of ability to have special knowledge and wisdom. This is the light. This is the starfire. This is the root to it. And that had gone because it had been taken away. We're now looking for it. The light, it is said, exists in everybody. It simply has to be awakened. There are various ways of awakening it, but the natural way, we are told in the oldest records I can find, is simply by will. Self-will is the route to the light, a thought-free consciousness, a plane of pure being. And they called this plane of pure being the plane of Sharon. It was actually this very concept of being, being through the starfire, being I am that I am, that became the problem for Jehovah when the edict against blood was issued. Even after Adam was said to have taken from the tree and eaten of the fruit, God in the Bible, Jehovah, says, "Look here, guys, the man has become one of us." Those are the words, nearly. Behold, actually. Behold. That's the sort of stuff God said. Behold. He has become one of us. He has taken from the plant of life. He has taken the star fire. He has taken the fruit. The teachings of the early dragon school are very, very specific about being or self-completeness. It was the key to everything that this succession was built up on. It's actually not too far adrift from what you guys are about today. You're doing it through a very different means, but what in actual fact you are doing is through the type of training that you're going through and the type of processes that you put your own mind through. You are actually, in your own way, creating higher production of these hormonal secretions which are enabling you to move into higher realms than would be norm in terms of cultural thinking. Behold, said Jehovah, the man is one of us. This is an interesting quote, and I think we'll have a little break after this just to get ourselves comfortable and do whatever we have to do, but this might interest you, this quote. This quotation comes from 2200 BC, and it's not too far adrift from the sort of things that we're talking about here today. Nothing, it said, is achieved by wanting. Nothing is achieved by relinquishing responsibility to a higher authority. Belief is the act of be living, for to be live is to believe. Belief is be living. Belief is be living. The will is the ultimate medium of the self. This is the root to the knowledge, it said. This is the root to the personal God, because the personal God is within and the self is God, the absolute consciousness, the kia, I am that I am. Okay, we'll just have a little break now. The next half's a bit longer. After that, we'll have a few questions, and then there's somebody that wants to take me off on a different track altogether. So we'll see you in about 15 minutes. Okay? While the last remainder of you are just getting ready to get comfortable and sit down, I'll just use a couple of pictorial images here just to remind you of a couple of things. This is the image we know for medical associations throughout the world. Pineal gland, brain's ventricles, spinal column, nervous system. This comes from old starfire ritual. It is what we associate today with medical institutions. What we also associate today with healing and emergency services is the Rosicrucius, the Red Cross. All of these old symbols are that old. And they exist today in medicine, in healing, in emergency services, and in everything to do with looking after people. Caneship. So let's look at it from the very beginning, and let's look now at why starfire was so important. Let's look at the principal and beneficial constituents that were eventually substituted by what became a chemical laboratory process. We've seen that Adam and Eve, jointly called the Adamae, Ataba and Eva, the earthlings were created clinically by Enki and Ninhursag. We're told in the books of old Shuma that this was done at a place called the House of Shimti. Shimti means breath, wind, life. Cain, according to Hebrew records and according to Sumerian records, was the son of Eve by Enki and not by Adam. His inherent Anunnaki blood was very, very potent. His wife was Lulava. She was the senior heiress to the matriarchal house of the dragon queen. Lulava was a pure-bred Anunnaki stock. Her sons by Cain were Aten and Henoch, better known as Etana
and Enoch. Sumerian records relate that King Etana of Kish partook of the plant of life in order to father his son, King Bali. The plant of life was directly associated with longevity and with kingship, kingship. The plant of life was starfire. Starfire was associated with feeding the pineal gland and producing the hormonal secretions. The early starfire, just to recap, was not anything to do with the high priestesses. It was strictly Anunnaki, the female essence which they called the nectar of supreme excellence. The Anunnaki flower or lily was held to be the cup bearer. The cup bearer in Grail lore became the bearer of the Grail. The Grail was the Rosicrucius, which represented the starfire of the womb, the cup of the waters. The cup bearer, the transmitter of the rich food, as they called it, was called the Rose of Sharon. And this comes from an old Sumerian word, shah, which means orbit, and on, which related to light, the orbit of light. She was the rose of the orbit of light, the Rose of Sharon. This significance is, in fact, venerated even in the Bible. In the Song of Solomon, lilies and roses were the bride placames to the Messianic king. I am the Rose of Sharon. I am the lily of the valleys. She is the bride of the starfire. The recipient king was considered to have become qualified for kingship when he reached a predestined state of enlightenment and achieved consciousness, a state when his aptitude for wisdom and leadership had reached the enhanced realm of kingship called the Malku. It was from the Mesopotamian word Malku that the Hebrews derived their word Malkus, which meant king, and Malkut, kingdom. Only in recent times, 1968, quite recently, did the hormonal secretion of the pineal gland become totally isolated by the medical world. The product of this particular gland was called melatonin. Many of you are familiar with this, I know. Melatonin comes from the Greek melos and tosos, which mean black labor, night worker. Those with high melatonin output actually react quite strongly against sunlight and are far better equipped to work at night. They are night operatives. They are melos tosos. Exposure to excess sunlight actually makes the pineal gland itself smaller. It lessens spiritual awareness. Darkness and high pineal gland activity enhance keen intuition, knowledge of the subtle mind. They also reduce the stress factor. It's at this stage, it's interesting to note how the Christian church actually demolished totally the true significance of the starfire ritual because they moved it into the realm of Gothic legend. The ultimate holders of the Malku in the old tradition, the dragons and pendragons, were Draco. Their conditioning through high supplementary melatonin and other hormonal secretions meant that they were people of the night. They were people of the starfire. They were, according to the Christian church, princes of darkness who thrived on the blood of virgins who were vampires. Draco. Dracul. Dracula. As we meet here tonight, on this very night, Halloween, there is taking place, maybe it's over now, I doubt it very much knowing these guys, started about midday at Boston University, a symposium of authors and historians from around the world to which I was invited. The chairman, Professor Raymond McNally, has called the meeting to commemorate the centenary of the publication of Bram Stoker's famous book, Dracula. 1897 it was published. It's not generally known, but Bram Stoker, who wrote this book, was an officer of the Sovereign and Imperial Court of the Dragon. He's also prominent as an officer in the Ordo Templi Orientis, the Order of the Eastern Temple, the most scientific branch of any Templar organization in the world, who were originally with the Essene Therapeutate Brotherhood of Qumran. The motto of this order is God is man. A lot will be discussed at the meeting today, tonight, but the main reason for calling the meeting was not just to celebrate the publication of a book, was that Bram Stoker's own papers on this centenary are going to be published. These are the papers which actually tell us, finally, the ultimate codes beneath which the adventurous Gothic romance imparts the secrets of alchemical tradition from the early mystery schools. The book Dracula is a book of codes. And I might have something more to say about that if I get back here again and don't get bitten by a vampire. So melatonin is created and manufactured by the pineal gland. It's activated through a chemical messenger called serotonin. This transmits nerve impulses across chromosome pairs at a point called meiosis, where the cell nuclei are halved, split, waiting to be combined with other halves upon fertilization. Melatonin enhances and boosts the body's immune system. Those with high pineal gland activity and secretion are less likely to develop cancerous diseases. High melatonin increases energy, stamina, physical tolerance. It's directly related to sleep patterns, and it has properties that operate through the cardiovascular system that keep the body very temperately regulated. Those of you who have high melatonin production will know that you are the night workers. This melatonin substance is actually the body's most efficient antioxidant. It has positive mental and physical anti-aging properties. The traditional symbol of kingship was gold. Pine resin, from which we get pineal, was what was used to make frankincense. Frankincense, as against gold for kingship, was the substance of priesthood, along with a third substance called myrrh, which was a gum resin used as a medical sedative and various other things. Myrrh was symbolic of death. In the ancient world, higher knowledge was identified as death, from which comes the word death. The words womb and tomb were absolutely identical. They were considered interchangeable and mutually supportive as routes to the higher knowledge. Womb and tomb, birth and death, routes to the higher knowledge. We know from the New Testament that Jesus, in fact, in the tradition of the old kings, was presented by the Magi with gold, with frankincense and myrrh. This, in the tradition, cements him, for those of us that may have doubted it, absolutely as a priest-king of the messianic dragon line. The pineal gland is impregnated by eternal ideas. It gives us the possibility of formulating our own conceptions. It's the organ of thought by which we learn to know and to change eternal ideas into earthly conceptions. There are those that believe that the pineal gland actually receives and sends vibrations, frequencies, thoughts, psychic phenomena, all transferred through the frequency of the pineal gland. It's been called the eye of wisdom, the eye of heightened self-awareness and inner vision. It's the key, say the yogics, to intuitive knowledge. the act of knowing rather than simply learning. Illuminists and Rosicrucians referred to the pineal gland as ayin, A-Y-I-N, ayin. Now this word has a number of definitions. It actually is a word used for eye. It can mean eye. The illuminist symbol was an eye within a triangle or an eye within a circle, the ayin, the eye. It also symbolizes, ayin symbolizes the root from which knowledge can actually come and become knowingness from absolutely nothing, from blackness, from darkness. It comes from the ayin. It comes from the blackness. It comes from the eye. Ayin, A-Y-I-N, with a C or a K in front of it, was exactly how the name Cain was originally spelt. We just translated it to C-A-I-N and got rid of the Y in some latter-day English translations. The name Cain means he of the blackness of the eye. It's from Cain, from Cain, that we derive the word king. And interestingly, originally, it was spelt with a Q. Q-A-Y-I-N, Quain. So king is synonymous with queen. There's no difference at all. King and queen were simply the sovereign figure, and the line was transferred through the female. It is said that spiritual people can actually perceive with this inner eye, an eye which, unlike mundane outer eyes, is not confused by physical presences. It actually reacts on seeing truth and knowing things. This is not new. This is the plane of Sharon. This plane of Sharon, which so many people have thought to be a sort of a field or something for hundreds of years, turns out to be the plane of the orbit of the light. It is the plane of knowing, a dimension which we can actually exist in, and those with higher pineal activity will exist more in that dimension, and this is why these people were fed the starfire. The Cainite kings were the first Pendragons of history. They were also of high Anunnaki substance, because the starfire increased their perception and general awareness. They were almost like gods themselves. Their stamina levels and immune systems were dramatically strengthened. Their anti-aging properties were immense. They had extraordinary lifespans, and I have read books and studied and tried to find out what these lifespans might have meant. People say there are codes in the numbers and all sorts of things. There is actually no secret or trick to them at all. They were real. They're not a code for anything. They lived a long, long time. In the Bible, we're told that during the lifetime of Noah and his sons, Jehovah issued the edict against the starfire. Thou shalt not take the lifeblood. This is what we're told by the writers of the 6th century BC. But actually, once one looks at it historically, there's something a little wrong here, because this Jehovah God, this Enlil, would never, at that moment in history, at about the time of Noah, have had any such authority to issue such an edict. So it rather looks as if the Bible writers have given us that story as if it happened at the time of Noah, but it probably happened a good deal later, after the family line had moved from Mesopotamia into Canaan. When did they do that? They did that at the time of Abraham. And remember what I said before, it's from the time of Abraham that suddenly the lifespans diminish. From that moment in time, once they move out of that area, the lifespans become pretty ordinary. However, in the line that they chose not to give us in the Bible, in the direct kingly succession from Cain, which we can actually follow through Mesopotamian and Egyptian history records, these high levels of age continued. So it's at that moment with Abraham, our dear patriarch, that actually the Davidic line suddenly got more and more normal. By the time it gets to King David, it suddenly becomes very special again. So it's terribly apparent that this line from Abraham's time moves somewhere else and comes back in. And it does exactly that. It moves into Egypt. What happens is that the line that we follow from Abraham to David is not the line that we should be following in this kingly succession. We should be following during that moment in time the line that were the pharaohs of Egypt. And that's where David's history comes straight back from. The lowly shepherd who with his sling slew Goliath was actually born straight out of pharaonic Egypt. Contemporary historical records tell us that at the time of Abraham, at about 2000 BC, the whole of Ur, the great capital of Shumer, was sacked by an invasion. That suddenly gives us a reason for why on earth it would be that somebody like Abraham, the head of a very senior family line, would suddenly up and leave his own country with his father and the rest of his family. In fact, we can date it more precisely. It's not around 2000 BC. These records are actually dated and paralleled along with other events of the time, and the year was absolutely precisely 1960 BC. So we know exactly the era of Abraham. So what really happened? What forced Terah and Abraham and Lot and the rest of the family to suddenly up and leave this great city which they were kings of? 1960 BC, we're told in the Sumerian and Akkadian records that in came Amorites from Syria and Elamites from Persia, and it says the quote, "And they overthrew and the order they destroyed. Then like a deluge, all things together they consumed, whereunto, O Shumer, did they change thee and the sacred dynasty from the temple they exiled." It's as clear as a bell. The sacred dynasty from the temple they exiled. It was at this stage of Sumerian history that the empire fell absolutely and totally. Abraham was forced to flee northwards. He fled from Ur into the city of Mari, north in the country, before going into Canaan. The records continue. Ur is destroyed. Bitter is its lament. The country's blood now fills its holes like a hot bronze in a mold. Bodies dissolve like fat in the sun. The temple, the dynasty, is destroyed. Smoke lies on our cities like a shroud. The Anunnaki have abandoned like migrating birds. Historically, this collapse of the Sumerian Empire, the moment when the Anunnaki abandon the place like migrating birds, immediately follows the historical ransacking of Babylon by Jehovah. The story of the Tower of Babel. It fits the time frame absolutely. The story of Genesis relates to us that the people were hitherto said by Jehovah to be very good, but were suddenly punished because of a very strange transgression that actually had never been previously described at all. This transgression was that they all spoke the same language, we're told. So God decided to confuse the language. In actual fact, their language was, of course, Sumerian, the oldest written language on earth. Their transgression, however, wasn't that they spoke the true language, the same language. In fact, Genesis tells us the transgression. And the transgression is that Jesus punished the people who had said, "Let us build a city and a tower whose top may reach to heaven, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad." Well, that's not actually made too much sense to anybody. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad. For that, Babel and the tower were smashed and the people were overrun. What the text actually used was a different word, and the word it used was Shem. Shem, from whence comes Shumer, Shema. "Let us make a Shem," it said, "lest we be scattered abroad." And there we suddenly discover that the word Shem was translated to name. Now there is a reason for that, and we'll come back to it. It does have a bearing on the word name. But in actual fact, the word Shem came from the term shamin, which means heaven. It derives from a root word, shama, which means that which is highward. Hashem was in fact a monument, a Highwood monument, in one of its respects, a Highwood monument, as Shem was actually the monument from which we eventually obtained those things which we call church spires and steeples. The conical, tall, Highwood monument, the Shem. However, a Shem was kind of more than that, because they weren't just big Shems, they were little Shems. And a Shem was Highwood, and the full name of the word was Shemana, Shemana. And Shemana meant a Highwood firestone. Highwood firestone. Firestone is the Shemana bit that's Anna. Shem is Highwood, firestone is Anna. When firestone isn't described as firestone, what else does it mean? Anna is translated in Sumerian and Akkadian to a bright, shining metal. So Shemana, a Highwood firestone, is a Highwood, or high, bright, shining metal. The use of the word Shem is apparent in the names of people of the era. There was a god called Shemesh, the brother of Queen Inanna. Shemesh was called the Shining One, Shemesh. Shem always meant shining when it was applied to people or to metallic things. Otherwise, it meant Highwood. Highwood, shining, meant the same things. It meant something in a high state, something that gleamed, something that was powerful. So back to Babylon. They're about to build their Shem to save themselves from being scattered abroad. But what do the historical documents tell us as against what the Bible tells us about this bit of the story? What they tell us, we've just heard, is that hordes of invaders came into the country. Amorites came in, Elamites came in. All of these people suddenly invaded and sacked the country at that time. God says in the Bible, Jehovah, that God, I shall come down and confound the language of all the earth. Well, in fact, what the historical records tell us is precisely that. At Enlil's destruction, invaders came in from all sides, and we knew not our own language anymore. The confusion of language was simply the influx of people from all around that suddenly had never been there before, because the gates of the cities were opened, because Jehovah Enlil was for some reason a bit put out. It is then said to us that the invasion was a direct result of friction amongst the Anunnaki Grand Council, because Enlil Jehovah had decided to assume the presidency because his father Anu was about to retire. The text continues, Anu went up to heaven, Enlil made the earth his subject, the seas enclosed with a loop were given to Enki. Now Enki was not happy about this, because although he was the younger of the two sons, his mother was the elder of the two sisters of their father. And Enki said, I may have been born after him, but I am the son of the senior mother, therefore I hold the kingship. The actual quote continues, I am Enki, the great brother of the gods. I am he who has been born as the first son of Anu. Well, in the midst of all of this, Enki and Enlil are battling this stuff out with the council, and Enki's son, a god called Marduk, decides to settle everything, and he assumes control, and the people, while the battle between the two brothers is going on, decide to support Marduk. He seems to be on their side, and rather than have Enlil scatter them abroad, banish them, kick them out of their country, they will raise a Shem, a monument to Marduk. Let us build a Shem, lest we be scattered abroad. So this is all too much for Jehovah Enlil. He decides that, having lost his own popularity to his brother Enki, that he's going to open up the gates of Shuma, let in the invaders from all sides, and the scribes record that then the terrible storm came, the culture was annihilated, the temple fell, the dynasty fell, and we saw a great confusion of tongues. The high gates, they said, the roads were piled with dead. The wide streets where the feasting crowds would gather lay scattered the bodies. In the streets the bodies lay, in the roadways the bodies lay, in the fields the bodies lay. No more dancers, now there are bodies laying in heaps, because Enlil has let in the invader. So all the work that had been done by the Anunnaki over thousands of years to build up this amazing civilization and to build up a line of kingship through starfire preservation and culture was destroyed in one fell swoop, and the dynasty barely managed to escape, and Abraham took the family up north and eventually went into Canaan. The Anunnaki at that stage, it is said, departed like migrating birds. So it appears that Enki and the others had gone. Who knows where? Maybe we'll find out. Enlil, Jehovah and his minions appeared to hang on for a while. We're told that Abraham communicated with Enlil, Jehovah in Canaan, calling him El Shaddai. Still the same thing, Il Kergal, Lord of the Mountain. But the book of Jasher then tells us something quite interesting, and this is another book that's left out of the Bible. In real terms, the God Jehovah, the Enlil God, last appears for the very final time in the Bible when he's there with Abraham trying to get him to slay his son Isaac. The book of Jasher, a book written long before the Bible, we know that because actually the records of ancient Babylon refer to the book of Jasher. Even the Bible refers to the importance of the book of Jasher, which means it was certainly written before it. The Bible tells us that Moses asked the Lord on the mountain what he should call him, because he didn't know who he was, because he knew he couldn't be Enlil or Enki. The God that Moses met was not the God, he was the Lord, and Jasher tells us that he was the great Lord Jethro of Midian, the man to whom Enki's ancestors had given the tablets of destiny, which he was to pass on to Moses. Lord High Jethro of Midian. Enlil had gone. Enki had gone. From the moment of Abraham's time, on this earthly plane, there is no further history of these deities, except in the mythology of their veneration. And what has perpetuated the mythology is the word Lord, because in their deputy stations, the seniors of the bloodline and the seniors of the priesthood took on the definition Lord, and whenever the Lord came up in any record that the Hebrews copied from, they decided that that was God. From 1960 BC, Jehovah, Enlil, and Enki had gone. Departed, it said, like migrating birds, whatever that means. We can guess. So, for all that had occurred up to that point, a significant change occurred in the starfire practice. There was no more starfire. The Anunnaki had departed like migrating birds. A substitute had to be found, and here we move in suddenly to a whole new chapter of history in the records, because we're moving into the first drug company. The substitute had to be found, but it appears that there is not a moment in the record where this appears to be a problem. It's all laid down, it's all predestined. There are a group of trained people whom the Anunnaki had designated master craftsmen. The first of these trained master craftsmen was Cain's, about sixth generation descendant, a guy called Tubal-Cain. Now, any of you who might have or might know people involved in Freemasonry will know that Freemasonry venerates Tubal-Cain. I have never in my lifetime found a Freemason who knows why they venerate Tubal-Cain, but they do. Tubal-Cain, sixth generation of King Cain, the king, was the father of Bilanos, who was the mother of Noah. Tubal-Cain was the world's first master craftsman, trained by Anunnaki, and the Bible tells us that he was the greatest metallurgist, an artificer in all kinds of metals. The principle of the master craftsman was absolutely straightforward. The records are in no way in any doubt about this. Their job was to manufacture starfire, gold of the gods. They had a rule, and the rule was simply this: to make gold, you must take gold. They knew what it meant. It's of particular interest, therefore, that when we move forward into the New Testament story, we discover that despite what it says in our modern-day English language translations, that Jesus' father, Joseph, in the earlier Greek editions of the Testament, tell us that he was a master craftsman. Jesus' father, Joseph, was a master craftsman. What happens when it gets translated into English? Well, our people think, what the hell is a craftsman? Carpenter of some sort, I suppose. He must be a carpenter. So Joseph becomes a carpenter. He's actually called a master craftsman, a great and skilled metallurgist. Not a woodworker at all. In the Old Testament book of Exodus, to revert back there, we go back to the time of Moses. Jehovah's now gone, Enlil's gone, Enki's gone, Jethro of Midian, the great Lord, is now in charge of everything. He holds the tablets of destiny. These are the tablets of cosmic knowledge left by the Anunnaki. Jethro appoints a certain Bezalel, the son of Uri ben Hur, to build the tabernacle and the Ark of the Covenant. Bezalel, it tells us, was a great and worthy goldsmith. He was, it says, a master craftsman. He was in charge of constructing the Ark of the Covenant and the tabernacle. In detailing how Bezalel should manufacture various crowns and rings and bowls and a candlestick and golden things galore, it tells us also that amongst his instructions was the making of something called shewbread. Shewbread. Without any explanation, the deed is done. We have him making the bowl and the candlestick and the shewbread and everything else, but nobody tells us what shewbread is. It's actually said to be the shewbread of the covenant. That's his description, the shewbread of the covenant. It's identified with the word covenant. The word covenant is identified these days with contractual agreements, with legal documents, with covenants, but actually it meant to eat bread with. The Lord's Prayer, which was established much about that time and resurrected later on in Christian times, makes a point. Give us this day our daily bread. It is taken to mean sustenance of some sort. It, in actual fact, was very specifically related to the shewbread of the covenant, the shewbread which, in fact, was one of the constituent followers of starfire. Leviticus, the book of Leviticus, takes us back again to shewbread. It doesn't specify it by name this time, and it says, take the white flour and bake the cakes thereof. Put pure frankincense in each row. Now, the word flour that we have today is actually a misnomer, because later on in the book it actually uses the word powder, and if one goes back to the original text, the same word was used each time. For some reason or other, they decided to tell us flour because we're talking about making bread. Both occasions the word is powder. So they're taking this powder, they're putting frankincense on it after they've made it. They're making starfire substitute. The mystery school records tell us more precisely that this white powder was gold. So suddenly, not only is red black and red gold, but now white is gold. This is pretty significant because in the book of Exodus, it tells us that Moses took the golden calf which the Israelites had made, burnt it in the fire, ground it to a powder, strewed it upon the water, and gave it to the children of Israel to drink. This is where the word powder is used correctly. But firing gold, he put it into the fire and produced white powder. Firing gold does not produce powder. Firing gold produces molten gold. So, what was this magical powder that was fed to the Israelites? Is there a way of transforming metallic gold into a white powder, like Moses was said to have done? Well, in actual fact, there is. Because to make gold, it said you must take gold. And white powder, it said, was gold. And the starting point for gold is gold. So to make the white powder, you begin with gold. And the story goes round in a circle, and we move into a particular avenue of early alchemical practice. Gold is noble, they said. Gold is truth. Through the regular use of the Anunnaki starfire, which was itself called the gold of the gods, the recipients were said to have moved into the realms of heightened awareness, consciousness, because of the inherent melatonin and serotonin. This was the realm of advanced enlightenment, which they called the plane of Sharon, the plane of the orbit of light, and the starfire was said to be the route through the light. So, this mundane, heavy darkness can be transferred into light, into gold. And this became the root of alchemical practice thereafter. Shewbread, the Hebrews called it. Shafa food, the Egyptians called it. It was the food of the Egyptian messiahs. And this is quite interesting to see this word coming up in Dragon Court records, the Egyptian messiahs. We associate messiahs with the Hebrew line, don't we? And pharaohs with the Egyptian line. In actual fact, they called them messiahs because they were anointed with the Messer, the fat of the Messer. They were the dragons. And so suddenly we're beginning to see that the David line does come back out of Egypt. It doesn't come straight from Abraham in the line that we're told. We can forget just about everybody that the Bible tells us was between Abraham and David. The line goes out and comes back in again. So, we have white powder, we have shewbread. What does that remind us of? It reminds us of something else in the Bible, another strange food substance that suddenly appeared at around the time of Moses. The people knew not what it was, it said. They thought it was snowing. This divine and wonderful food, what was it, they said? What was it? It is manna. If we read Josephus' Antiquities of the Jews, he actually explains that the particle manna, the M-A-N, man from manna, in the Jewish language means what is it? That's all it means, what is it? Manna means what is it? This strange, mysterious food, the secret, the hidden manna, means what is it? In actual fact, the interesting thing about the word manna is that if one looks back at the earliest documents, we find that even what is it, manna, is an abbreviation of Shemanna. Shemanna, remember, was Highwood Firestone. What is it? It is Highwood Firestone. What is Highwood Firestone? When the children of Israel saw it, they said to one another, it is manna, because they knew not what it was. Moses said, this is the bread. The manna is then described to be white. The manna is then said to be like snow. The manna is said to taste sweet, like honey. And they called it bread. When the Ark of the Covenant was completed, Moses' brother Aaron was said to have placed an omer full of manna into the Ark. And the New Testament book of Revelations continues the story. It says, to him that overcometh, I will give the hidden manna. I will give the white stone, and in the stone will be a name, a new name written, which no one knoweth except he who receiveth it. Much later, in Grail lore, in European Grail lore, and we're now moving forward to the 1200s, comes this quote. Around the end of the stone is an inscription in letters, and it tells the name and the lineage of those, be they maids or boys. Those are they who make the journey to the Grail, and nobody can read the inscription on the stone except they whom it is for, and then it vanishes. So there's a direct parallel here between something from the book of Revelation and something from Grail lore of the Middle Ages, and it refers to a stone, and it refers to whiteness, and it refers to a name. And the word Shem, if we remember, was translated into name. Let us make a name, lest we be scattered abroad. In actual fact, name is equivalent because of its use here. Highwood, Firestone, Shem, Anna was manna, and this was associated with a name, and the name was the lineage. The name was the Grail. In Chartres Cathedral in France, there is a statue of the great priest king Melchizedek, who offered the bread and the wine to Abraham. It's a very, very unique statue, this, because all other statues of priests offering bread and wine, which was a communion custom, are showing them offering bread and offering wine. But Melchizedek's statue from the time of Abraham is immensely different, because he is offering a chalice, and in the chalice is the bread. It's in it. It's not separate. It's called bread and it's called wine, but actually all one sees there is bread. And this is very interesting. And the reason that it's interesting, as the Templar records tell us, is that it depicts and describes the very moment when the wine, the redness, the starfire, the blood of the chalice was substituted for the new bread. The time of Melchizedek, suddenly it was starfire no more, it was manna. It was suddenly not the natural product anymore, it was suddenly a manufactured product, and it was white gold. This bread, it was said, was used to feed the light body as against the physical body, and it makes a point of telling us that. As far back as 2200 BC, they're actually talking about the secretions of glands in the human body. The pharaohs, in their travels, as written in the Book of the Dead and in other European archives, keep telling us that at each stage of a pharaoh's journey, he is still asking, what is it? What is it? Shem Anna. It is the manna, it is the gold, it is the white food. In the alchemical tradition, something called the Philosopher's Stone is said to be that which translates base elements into gold. This is deemed to be the case in the higher metallurgical sense and also in the spiritual sense of enlightenment, moving the mundane person into a higher state of being, transferring his lead into gold. So, the rule was to make gold, you must take gold. There are two distinctly different forms of gold. There is the straightforward metal that we know, gold, we all know what that looks like, but there is also a higher state of gold, the gold that is in a different dimension of perceived matter, the white powder of gold that suddenly doesn't look like metal anymore. It's the hidden manner, it's become hidden because it doesn't look like what it is. It's still gold, and its secret was known by the master craftsman. In the alchemical document called the Rosarium Philosorum, the hidden stone was described in terms of geometry. Make a round circle of the man and the woman, draw out of this a square, out of the square a triangle, make a round circle, you will have the stone of the philosophers. We all recognize that as Vitruvian Man, the drawing by Leonardo da Vinci, the square, the man. They say this is the Philosopher's Stone. It's not the Philosopher's Stone, but geometrically this is a representation. I tried to find out from numerous people exactly what the Philosopher's Stone represented. Was it really a stone? Was the stone a symbol for something? Was it actually a stone because it was metal, even though metal is metal and not mineral? And I was told a very strange answer, and perhaps I'll learn more in time, but I was told that the concept of the stone is rather like the half cup of water. To some of us, the cup is half empty, and to others, the cup is half full. So is a stone a pebble, or is a stone a gem? And our own intuition will lock us straight into one of those things, and there will be those of us who are positive and those of us who are negative. And the positive people will find the root of the stone, I'm told. In the Grail romance of Parsifal, written in the Middle Ages again, it is said of the Temple Knights of the Grail Castle, they live by virtue of a stone most pure. If you do not know its name, now learn it. It is called Lapit Exilis. By the power of this stone, the phoenix is burned to ashes, but the ashes speedily restore it to life, and the phoenix thus molts and thereupon gives out a brilliant light so that it is suddenly as beautiful as before. Now, lots of people have wondered about lapis exilis because it appears to be a play on words. It combines two things, it seems. Lapis exilis means stone from the heavens. Lapis elixir, or elixir, is likened very often to the philosopher's stone itself, the stone by way of which base elements are transformed into higher states of being, into gold, realistically or symbolically. Either way, whichever we're looking at, whether we're talking about stones from heaven or elixir stones, we're talking about shemana. We're talking about the heavenly stone, the highwood firestone, the manna that was the substitute for starfire. So the Parzival allegory lies in the description, it seems, that the phoenix is burned to ashes and appears again in a light as bright and beautiful as ever before. But what's a phoenix? What's a phoenix? It's a bird, we answer. The Bennu bird. No. The word phoenix is far, far older than any mythology about birds. The word phoenix is of the most ancient Phoenician, and the word phoenix means red gold. Starfire. This is the story of the starred fire that will turn things, no matter how they're destroyed, into something brighter and more beautiful than before. The interesting thing about the starfire symbolism is that there are still, within certain orders, starfire rituals carried out today. They're, of course, wholly symbolic, just like Freemasonry is, and ceremonies, and most of the time people don't know what the hell it is that they're doing. Because they tell us the secrets have been lost, and that one day, if we keep performing the rituals, the secrets will be returned. And once they are here, we at least have the ceremonies practiced and can get going again. Well, one of these rituals, in fact, uses to represent starfire. Quite often it's the cross and the circle, but one of them, and this is an interesting one, this is a ninth degree ceremony from one of the Templar orders, and it's starfire symbolism. And again, this can be traced way, way back, back beyond records of Hebrew law. And it's very much associated with Hebrew law because they have two triangles to represent starfire. One is an ordinary upright triangle, and they say that this is the triangle of gold, which will become light. And they also have another triangle, which somebody else carries around, and this triangle is turned up the other way. And they say this triangle represents water. It represents blood, it represents matter. So this triangle here represents the spirit, it represents the light, it represents the gold, and this one represents the water and the blood, it represents matter. And when they've been through the ceremony, they interlock these triangles together and they get that. And it is called the gem. When it's finally interlocked together, the spirit with the matter, it is called the gem. Now, quite what allegory is involved here, I'm not absolutely sure, but these same people have said to me before, a stone can be a pebble or a stone can be a gem. So clearly this allegory of starfire symbolism is very much locked into early philosophers' stone heritage. Old Alexandrian texts call it the stone of paradise. This is interesting stuff because it carries on with something that gets more and more stunning once we learn about modern metallurgy and aspects of alchemy, because we're now with an Alexandrian text that goes back to BC years, and it says, that the philosophers, no, it doesn't call it the philosopher's stone, it calls it the stone of paradise. The white stone of paradise, the stone of the name, when placed on the scales can outweigh its quantity, but when covered to dust, even a feather will tip the scales against it. It's interesting stuff, isn't it? We have something that can outweigh itself on the scales, but when covered to dust, when turned to powder, even a feather can be heavier than it. Those of you who have seen the David Hudson video will get an inkling of where this appears to be going now. Is there a formula for this, I said? Is there a formula somewhere here? Something that they worked to? And the answer was, yeah, of course there were formulas. There were mathematical formulas. There were recipes and all sorts of things. But the formula upon which the whole of this process is based on is this. It's very simple. Naught equals plus one plus minus one. Naught equals plus one plus minus one. Now that's very straightforward, isn't it? Because one plus minus one does actually equal naught. Very straightforward, and I thought, well, this is pretty good stuff for the cleverest people in the world to have worked that out. But they then said, think about it. This is a sum that can only work when it is a sum. It can never work when it's applied to reality. If you have a plus something, a plus one of these, you can't add a minus one of these to it and turn out nothing, because it's still there. You could actually minus it and put it behind your back and pretend it's nothing, but actually it's still something. So the sum suddenly becomes daunting. This easy sum becomes something quite impossible. You cannot add minus one of something to a plus of itself to end up with nothing. And they smiled and said, can't you? Well, it seems that you can. And in fact, they then begin talking once again about the plane of Charon, the plane of the orbit of light. Because something which is actually truly and absolutely nothing to us is very simply something which we can't see. Doesn't actually mean it doesn't exist. It's not hidden, it's not put somewhere else. We can't see it, therefore it is nothing. But actually we're surrounded all the time by a lot of something that is nothing. We are simply not aware of it, we do not perceive it, we cannot see it, touch it or taste it. Doesn't mean it's not there, it just means it's in a different dimension. This, they say, to us is nothing. We can have plus it, we can add to that minus it, and we can move it into another dimension. When it is in that other dimension, even a feather will tip the scales against it, because not only can we make it weigh less than itself, we can actually make it physically disappear. Well, this is interesting again, and it would have meant little to me unless I'd seen the David Hudson video, because once again, we're straight back into exactly what these experiments showed us. That in fact, one can take metal, one can turn metal into white powder, one can actually make it weigh a lot more than itself, like it said in the Alexandrian text, or one can make it so that even a feather tips the scales against it. Or it can actually disappear totally from sight. Doesn't mean it's not gone, because you can bring it back. It has simply moved into the plane of Charon. The metal that we commonly know as white gold suddenly becomes of importance in this now. Because when you go back to the early text, not only are we talking about starfire and red gold, but we're suddenly talking about white gold. Not just white powder, but white gold. Now, white gold today is something which we use in jewelry, and generally it's made by taking a metal called palladium and mixing it with ordinary gold. Palladium's a very hard, white, non-tarnishing metal, and it belongs to the platinum group. It was first discovered in Brazil and California in the Urals in 1803. Other hard metals of this same platinum group are iridium, osmium, rhodium, ruthenium. And because of their ultimate strength, these hard white metals are used in all sorts of precision industries. They're used to make machine bearings. They're used in surgical and optical instruments. They're used in crucibles and thermocouples and all manner of things, right down to pen nibs. The little silver bit dipped on the end is one of these platinum metals. Palladium is said to have been discovered in 1803. Iridium, osmium, rhodium are given precisely the same date. Ruthenium followed in 1843, but according to the old Sumerian records, these dates are actually wrong because they knew about them then. What we have in all of our encyclopedias are the dates of rediscovery. Like many secrets of old, they can disappear for hundreds, maybe thousands of years because somebody has decided to contrive history against them. They actually comprised the very metallic group which, in looking at the word, because they believed it couldn't be anything else, historical writers have termed tin, because the Sumerians described the shining white hard metal of the Shemana, the Highwood Firestone of the white gold. When learning about the things that they used to do with this, it is quite apparent that it wasn't tin, because tin would never be strong enough to make some of the stuff they were using this for. They were actually doing the equivalent of hip joint replacements with Highwood Firestone. From these firestones, they achieved the state called Highwood. Suddenly we're beginning to learn that it doesn't just mean something that goes up. It doesn't just mean something that shaped Highwood. It's actually now being referred to in the master craftsman's documents as the Highwood state. The Highwood state. What is the Highwood state? What is it? What is it? Manner. What is it? It is the metal in the Highwood state. Today, it falls into a category that we call high spin metallurgy. Only by understanding the science of high spin metallurgy can one take something and add to it its equivalent of nothing and apply the principle of naught equals plus one plus minus one. This is the point at which one could branch right off and go into hours and hours about alchemy and turning metals into gold and all of this sort of stuff. The important thing to recognize here is not that. This is not a lesson on medieval alchemy. It's for us to appreciate that there were metals used at the time that they were maneuvering the master craftsman into a Highwood state, a high spin state. A state at which the electrons react differently to they do in the normal metallic state. And at that point, we're actually moving the metal into another direction, into a Highwood state, into a high spin state. The Highwood Firestone, Firestone, Anna, Shem, Anna. It is hard, it is shining. It is probably a metal of the platinum group. Through sequences of heating and cooling, it has been proved now that one can actually take these metals and cause them to rise and fall hundreds of times their optimum weight and weigh down to less than nothing. We are moving them then into the plane of Sharon. So this is the story, really, of the succession, not from Adam to David and to Jesus, but the succession from Cain to David and Jesus. And unfortunately, poor old Adam wasn't part of that program, but Eve was. Cain was the Cain. It wasn't a name. He was the Cain, the kin, the king, the blood relative. The blood relative of who? The Bible tells us that Eve says, "I have gotten him from the Lord," and the Lord was Enki. Enki means archetype. Now, it is very interesting. There are many words, many names historically given to people because we knew what they became. We just give them as back titles to people, sort of posthumously, and we know them by that name because that is what they became. At the time this was happening, they were calling Enki the archetype. It wasn't something that people thousands of years later decided to label him. They called him that then, the archetype. We have the beginning of the succession which created not only the kingly line of Judah, but the original kingdoms of Egypt, in both of which countries they carried out the starfire practice. The only difference with Egypt was that they took it onto a mundane level and introduced the scarlet women, the hierogulae, the harlots, the whores, the dearly beloved, and eventually even the Egyptian metallurgists moved in, because in fact the starfire of the dearly beloved didn't match that of the Anunnaki when it finally came to playing the kingly game. What they did was to work out the most logical thing in the world. Instead of feeding you these secretions directly to give you more of them, instead of giving you a hormone replacement or a hormone supplement, why don't we actually do something far more clever? Why don't we feed you with something that will make your own personal glands produce far more of this hormone secretion? That way, you're producing it for yourself. You don't have to be taking a supplement from somewhere else. There are today chemical companies in the organotherapy industry who can and will supply melatonin, serotonin, and these sort of hormone supplements. There is an immense difference between these, which are made from the desiccated glands of dead animals, to that which comes from the human live animal. Even if they came from live ordinary animals, it would be better. These melatonin and serotonin supplements are taken from dead animals, at which point the secretion has been failed from the moment of death. It begins to die pretty well immediately. By the time you get it desiccated and sold to in its bottles or pills or whatever, it is pretty well as useless as taking a chocolate biscuit. You've actually got to take quite a lot of it. It is not live melatonin, it is dead melatonin. This, with a bit of luck, might help you through jet lag. It might help you stay up a little bit that later on that night that you've got to work a bit harder. It might give you a little edge on all sorts of things by which your body's general metabolism might have been collapsing and needs a bit of a boost. It will not actually give you long life or anti-cancer or any of the things that the original starfire or substitute did. So instead of taking the stuff, they produced the first manufactured drug, the first supplement. It actually charged your glands to make them produce more of these hormones. And what was that made out of? It was made out of metal. It was manna. It was shemana. It was what is it? It was shefa food. It was whatever you like to call it, shoe bread, but it was made out of gold and it was made out of platinum, and tests have now proved the difference between the two. There is no doubt whatsoever that the old records were correct, because when they tell us what the white gold did as against what the red gold did, this now proves out scientifically that the red gold, the gold, affects the pineal gland absolutely. The white gold, the platinum group metals, affect the pituitary gland. By taking the substances from both, you will be producing both melatonin and serotonin. Serotonin feeds the pineal and produces more melatonin, so by taking both of them, you are going to end up taking from the plant of life, and just as Jehovah said in Genesis, behold, he's becoming like one of us. I think that'll do for now. Let's have a few questions. Thank you. Thank you. I think we've still got a little bit of time left, so if anybody wants to ask any specific questions, there's a microphone at the back, I'm told, and you can talk to me from there. If I know it, I'll answer it.
I was fascinated by your talk, and I had recalled a few, what I think are some tantalizing fragments that support a lot of what you told us tonight. What I was curious to know, I know that you're the prior of the Celtic Church, or I'm not exactly sure of your office or what is how to refer to it, but I wanted to know if you were aware that the Catholic Church in Yelm is dedicated to St. Columban, and I think that's a interesting correspondence. You know, that
the Catholic Church here is dedicated to St. Columban.
The Roman Catholic Church is called St. Columban's, yeah.
Interesting.
So I think you're in the right place, I guess.
that is interesting. There is an interesting story behind that, actually. That what I am is prior of the Sacred Kindred of St. Columba, which is in fact the royal ecclesiastical seat of the Celtic Church. Uh-huh. The Kindred of St. Columba was the Celtic priesthood of royal blood, so only the relatives of the kings and queens of Scots and Northern Ireland were within the Sacred Kindred, so I'm Britain's prior of that now.
Yes.
The Columba thing and the Catholic thing is terribly interesting. St. Columba, the great leader of the Celtic Church, died in the year 579, and without wasting, I think, something just under 3 weeks, the Pope from Rome had sent St. Augustine over to Britain to try and take over and demolish the Celtic Church on behalf of the Church of Rome, because he said there are a lot of pagans. They drink wine and dance to drum music. Anyway, so St. Augustine comes over to Britain and he proclaims himself Britain's first Archbishop of Canterbury, and he manages to kick the Celtic Church pretty well out of England and moves it into Wales and Scotland and Ireland, and that's essentially where it's been ever since. What is interesting is that because the Celtic Church's popularity was retained century after century after century, it actually got to the point where the people of Britain and the people of the Western Christian world generally had kind of forgotten that St. Augustine and the Roman Church and St. Columba and the Celtic Church were the bitterest of enemies, because all of a sudden these are just people from the dim, distant past that are called saint something or other, and saints are just people of the Christian Church. And so suddenly, from about 1500, which is kind of before any churches would have been built over here, but only, you know, a century or so before, from about 1500, the Catholic Church and the Church of England both started to change some of their church dedications to St. Columba. So it's a bit of a trick they're pulling on us, actually. He's not a Catholic saint at all.
you referred to the word Quinn, Q-U-I-N, I believe. Did you?
Q-U-A.
Oh, Q-U-A-N, Queen?
No, sorry, Q-A-Y-I-N.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, that's something else. All right. Questions are limited, so I'll turn the mic over.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. I'd like to regress a bit. I was wondering, okay, Jehovah said to Noah, no more drinking of the blood as such, but nothing significant happened till Abraham. Is there anything in the dragon records of a flood or anything? Is there anything to support the Bible and like this huge event by the Bible?
And no, not really. I mean, what seems to happen with the Old Testament, certainly with the earlier books, not so much as history progresses and it becomes real history, but this early stuff, I mean, they're writing this up from thousands of years before. So the books of Moses, Genesis and Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy, are books of pretty ancient history. And what seems to have happened within them is that there are lots of events that actually are based on substantial things, but have got out of sequence. Even the flood itself, in true history, that the flood has nothing to do with the Noah period, it actually comes before the Adam period. It's just got switched around because it suits the better novel. You know, the story is better, it has a nice flow. But the blood thing, you see, that this rule is given to the time of Noah. But actually, so is the flood. And that the flood is historically the best known example of something that is totally out of chronological context. So the point that I make is probably the blood thing is equally, which actually leaves Noah a little bit out in the cold with having nothing much to do with anything too much. What it does is to bring Abraham more fully into the picture, because in essence the story of the blood and the sort of beginning of the movement towards a Jewish faith that supported Jehovah really comes from the Abraham time, not from the Moses and Noah era before. We're presented with these people as if they were actually Jews and Hebrews, but they certainly weren't. I mean, the word Jew simply comes from the country name of Judea, and the word Hebrew comes from the name Heber, who was, I think, the great-grandfather of Abraham. So there's no way that people like Noah and all the others before were actually Jews, Hebrews, or anything at all. The story of the Jewish faith seems to begin with Abraham, and that's why he is the great patriot father.
So Noah just wasn't important. Noah wasn't important.
Well, I mean, clearly he was important to somebody. I suspect his wife loved him, you know. The important thing about Noah was that his wife was Bilanus, who was the daughter of Tubal-Cain. And the importance of Noah was that whether he liked it or not, he fathered the strain, the important strain from the Cain line that came in after him. So what I'm really saying is that nothing really is important in the line from Seth to Noah. The line then becomes important from Noah onwards because it's now moved in with this other line that was the key line. But then it drifts away again, and it comes back again a little before David from Egypt.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Very illuminating. Thank you so much. Had the origin of the theory of the Jews' claims of being God's chosen people had anything to do with their being privy to the starfire rituals and its subsequent knowledge of longevity?
I wouldn't be at all surprised. Okay. The problem with things like God's chosen people, it's difficult to know where things like this begin. What you have is an edict which is credited to a point in time, but it's actually only being written up today. It is said that then we became God's chosen people.
I was just wondering if in your
research... But yeah, you see, what they would have had was access to the Tablets of Destiny. They would have had access to early Kabbalah. They would have had access to starfire ritual and all of these things. So on that basis, what seems to have occurred here is something which occurs throughout the Old Testament. There are many, many, many references where the word God is used. Not Jehovah particularly or Lord, but where the word God is used. Now, the difficulty with the word God is that the original word that this God word was translated from was Elohim, or variations of that, and this was a plural word. It was actually a non-gender word. Elohim meant gods, it equally meant goddesses. It didn't mean the or a god. So in essence, what one could presume here is that what they were saying was, we were the chosen people of the gods and goddesses, not that God's chosen people. We were the chosen people of the gods, and clearly they were. We know that Jethro of Midian had the tablets of destiny. We know also that the sons of Lamech, Tubal-Cain and his brothers, inherited the tablets of destiny. So we know that these things were held in that family line. The problem was that they forsook them all for the sake of a faith of fear, which actually forbade them to use this knowledge. And it was lost for hundreds of years. But there were Kabbalists and secret societies and all sorts of mystical schools who continued the practices and continued with the knowledge. But they had very, very little to do with the average Hebrew. The average Hebrew was still wandering around trying to find a territory and wondering why his God didn't like him very much. And it rather seems that because of that, although their family spawned the greatest kingly line in history, the rest of its history doesn't amount to very much.
Well, can one infer that the Hebrew religion is an outgrowth of their relationship with the Anunnaki?
I think the Hebrew religion, as it is an outgrowth from fear of Jehovah. Strictly that. I mean, it is a faith founded on fear, just like the Christian religion, which followed it. You know, if one had to sum up what is the ultimate basis of the Christian religion, it is that it holds us all in fear of the unknown. And only by, again, abiding by the dogma of God's chosen people, whom we don't call Jews but we call bishops, can we be actually saved from this unknown, because they hold the key. They are the priests, they are the bridges between us and the unknown. The fact is that I'm not too sure how much of the unknown they know about.
Thank you.
The family of Windsor has a very strange history. It's the one house in British history, I suppose, apart from the House of Stuart, but in English terms, that didn't actually come along with swords and fight their way to the throne. The Anglo-Saxons came and knocked the Celts out, and the Normans came and knocked out the Anglo-Saxons, and the Plantagenets dealt with them, and then the Tudors won a battle. And most of England's changes of dynasty have happened because of force of arms. Somebody has wiped out the dynasty before and taken over. The House of Stuart was brought in from Scotland because England was in such a mess, and Elizabeth was deemed not to have a child, Queen Elizabeth I, so her nearest relative was the King of Scots at the time. Absolute rubbish. Her nearest relative was Edward Seymour, Lord Beecham, whose heir now should actually be the King of England. The Scots were brought in for one reason, and that was to get rid of the House of Stuart, because the House of Stuart were allowing freedom of worship. And that wasn't actually liked by the English very much, because they'd become totally and utterly Anglican, and there were people up in the north of the country able to be Catholics or Jews or whatever they wanted, and the people had no such right of individual choice. So we'll bring this King of Scots down to England and then depose them. And that's exactly what they did. But the House of Hanover came in by government whim. And the beauty of the House of Hanover, which became the House of Windsor, was that they didn't speak any English. So in 1714, George of Hanover, an elector of Hanover, a small kingdom in Germany, was invited to become King of Britain. He couldn't speak English, he couldn't write English, he couldn't read English. He was King of England for 17 years and spent about 10 months in the country. And so that was jolly useful. And at that moment in time, politics took over English kingship. Various laws were passed which took away the rights of sovereigns. So that the Hanoverian family, given no rights to be anything very much at home, from the time of George II to the time of Queen Victoria, decided that a jolly good plan was to build up an empire abroad. Because that would keep them out of having to worry about people in Britain. They could go off to Africa and India and slaughter a few people and build up an empire. So that's what they did, and it was jolly good fun for a while, and it put a lot of pink bits on the map. But we have a rule in Britain, and the rule says that the royal line must succeed through the male. This is not old Egyptian or Hebrew law. This is England now. It must succeed through the male line. So Queen Victoria of the House of Hanover is a woman. Interesting. She marries Prince Edward of Saxe-Coburg, another German prince, and the house immediately, from the time of their son, Edward, becomes the House of Saxe-Coburg. Now, there's a parallel here, because this has happened again with our other Elizabeth. The queen marries, the family takes on the name of the husband. We now have the House of Saxe-Coburg. We historians call it the House of Hanover-Saxe-Coburg, just so that we don't forget. In 1917, in the middle of the First World War, King George V thinks, well, our family is not too popular at the moment because actually the people are beginning to remember that we're German. And to be honest, if they get hold of any letters or correspondence, they see that we've never talked a word of English in Buckingham Palace to this day. They spoke and wrote in German. So he said, I know what we can do. Here's a jolly good idea. Edward I, back in the 12th century, was called Edward Windsor. Why don't we change our name to Windsor? That's a jolly good English name. And we've got a castle called Windsor Castle, and so we'll call ourselves Windsor. So the Windsor House was born just out of a change of name, but it didn't make it any less the House of Hanover, Saxe-Coburg, Windsor. From that moment on, its story wasn't too happy because poor old Edward, King Edward VII, was in court more than he was on the throne. Debts to gambling houses, debts to prostitutes, debts to his tailors and cabinet makers and everybody else. So he wasn't a very clever guy. And we sort of fumble through a couple of kings, and we get to Edward VIII, and here's the beginning of a wonderful story, because Edward VIII is forced to vacate the throne. We are told because he was going to marry or had married Mrs. Wallis Simpson, an American lady. And this wasn't on because she wasn't exactly a German princess, and we couldn't have that. Well, in actual fact, there was a lot more to it because Mrs. Simpson had nothing to do with that story at all. She was bigamous, and Edward was already married to a woman in Canada. The relevance was, and the film clips are now beginning to be released, is that Edward was under promise from Hitler in the Second World War to be the person who would be left as the only operative king in the Third Empire of Germany. He would be paid by the German state, he would be upheld by the German state, and he would effectively be a junior king under the German regime. Edward was forced to abdicate because of this. Mrs. Simpson was the scapegoat. And Edward VIII moves into history in his den of Arcadia and balls and passes and everything else that we know about the ostentatious spending of that part of the family. His poor brother, Albert, then has to become king, but Albert hasn't been to a very good school at all. Nobody ever thought he was going to be king, and he had a stutter. And he was impotent, and he had various problems, but he was going to be king. So George got the job as being king, and it was quite apparent that he was not going to be a very effectual king. They decided that one way to make him better was that King Albert didn't actually sound that good, so we may as well call him King George VI. That sounds much stronger and more Hanoverian. That's better. We'll call him that. So they called him King George VI, and enabled to stabilize the position, because now the world is rocked against Germany. It is known, the truth about Edward VIII is known. people are being sent across to Germany to try and pull out records and correspondence between the Nazi leaders and Edward. And it is decided that the way to save the royal family is to marry into a completely different breed. And we get the marriage to Elizabeth Bowes Lyon, who is of Scottish heritage, and they played the Scottish card to its hilt. Actually, you have to go back seven generations to find anybody in her paternal or maternal family that wasn't born in the middle or south of England. The Scottish title was ancient, but her father was a member of the Royal Stuart Society and did, in fact, resign from that society so that she could marry the king. What then happened, of course, was that there were two daughters, both born through artificial insemination. We have Elizabeth and we have Margaret. And we end up back in a situation which is not now dissimilar from that which applied before, because we now have a woman inheriting the throne of Britain. If a woman inherits the throne of Britain, just as Victoria found out, the house has to change its name to the name of her husband. That's why Hanover became Saxe-Coburg. However, this is very strange, because Elizabeth is now going to marry somebody who hasn't got a name. She's not queen yet. Her father, George, is still alive. And in 1946-7, she is now going to marry somebody who we know as Philip of Greece. We are told today that he's Philip of Greece. I have more Greek blood in my American jacket than Philip has in his body. The story behind Philip is a very straightforward one. Philip's grandfather applied for a job in the Danish press. And the job said, please apply anybody who would like to become king of Greece. Anyway, his grandfather got the job. He was born of Germanic Danish blood. But he got the job of king of Greece. He was a reasonable king. But his son, Andrew, Philip's father, was a different kettle of fish. Andrew wasn't much good at anything, and Andrew actually managed to get himself charged with treason in Greece for organizing a very strange military campaign against the Turks, from which he fled the field, and 1.5 million Greeks lost their lives. He and his generals were charged with treason, and this is all going on at about the time that Elizabeth is going to marry his son. The British Foreign Secretary has to send out a gunboat to rescue the family in the dead of night and to bring Philip and the others across the water. But these people are stateless, they have been banished, they have surname, and they are certainly not royalty. Back in Britain, the marriage goes ahead. And George says, well, okay, there's not a lot I can do about it. But the wonderful thing is that you haven't got a surname, old chum, so at least your family can't nick the House of Windsor. Also, since you have no royal status and you are internationally banished and your father is under charge of treason, you cannot even be a prince in my country. So you will never be a prince in Britain. Prince Philip does not exist. He was given the title Duke of Edinburgh, and the only reason he couldn't be Prince of Scotland like we have a Prince of Wales is because the House of Stuart has always been Princes of Scotland. Duke of Edinburgh was the best they could give him. He then queued up after the war, and for 10 shillings, he bought himself a British passport along with refugees from all over Europe. He still didn't have a surname. He took his uncle's name of Battenberg, which in the meantime had been changed to Mountbatten because that didn't sound quite so German at a dodgy time. So we now have Philip Mountbatten. Now then a very strange thing begins to happen, because what people forget was that Philip's uncle, Earl Mountbatten of Burma, was a very, very powerful person internationally. In naval terms, he was Lord of the Admiralty, powerful man. So he immediately comes forward, and we're now in 1947, and said, okay, this family has to become the House of Mountbatten. Not necessarily from the time that Philip and Elizabeth marry, or even from the time that she inherits the throne, but from the time that their first son or offspring inherits, this will be the house of Mountbatten. Now, this was actually a problem for Parliament and for everybody else. The problem was that all of the heraldic colleges, all of the colleges of arms in Britain, be it in Scotland, England, or wherever, agreed with Earl Mountbatten and said, well, we don't actually like you or the idea very much, but yes, legally, you are correct. Well, anyway, the battle went on, and the battle went on. Winston Churchill sort of saved the day, and there was a bit of paying off going on, and the thing went very quiet, and Earl Mountbatten knew that it wasn't going to matter at all, anyway, until Charles, the eldest son, or whoever, became king. Which might be soon, or it might not be soon. In fact, he might not be king for a long time, so the first time he actually has to begin to make any noise about it is when Charles marries and produces an heir. So we're now moving towards the Diana period. Earl Mountbatten is still on the scene. Earl Mountbatten is waiting to turn this into a coup and to get it back to being the House of Mountbatten, which he feels sounds still a good deal nicer and more German than Windsor. So we come to 1979, by which time plans are already afoot for Charles to marry Diana. Although we in the public field didn't hear about it at that time, and they didn't get married until 81, the plans were afoot in 79, at which time Earl Mountbatten of Burma, Debrett's, Burke's Peerage, and all the colleges rose up again and said, hey guys, House of Mountbatten on the way, because these people will have a son. Well, the argument prevailed, and the argument raged, and legally everybody knew that Earl Mountbatten of Burma was correct. Charles had been strategically married into the Spencer line to clean up the blood. They were suffering from all sorts of problems, impotency, haemophilia, all the things that had happened because of too much very close interbreeding within the family. But Diana's job was simply to produce an heir. However, Mountbatten saw what had happened was a door had been opened and the House of Mountbatten was now on the horizon. Wrong. He was very strangely blown up in his boat and that was the end of him. And for a lot of years, they blamed the IRA. And nobody could actually quite understand why the IRA should want to blow up Mountbatten. You know, there's plenty of politicians and people they would have really have done it to. But nobody understood that, and they always said it wasn't us. In fact, nasty people as we may be, we terrorists of the IRA lunatic fringe, we would always tell you when we blew somebody up, otherwise there's no point in us doing it. You wouldn't know it was us. I mean, we would gain nothing. In fact, if we managed to do a job like that, we would be really proud that we've been that clever, and we'd certainly make sure that you knew, but actually, sorry, wasn't us. Well, in fact, it was only a very few years ago that the government finally announced that they knew it wasn't the IRA. Well, the only way they could know it wasn't the IRA is to actually know who it was, and of course they knew who it was right from the start. And from that moment, scenes of old time history began to come to people's minds, and you could see that this element of politics, this element of if they don't go quietly, if they don't agree with our dogmas and our arguments, we'll make jolly sure that they're not around for too long and they won't get in our way for any longer than we can help. So from that moment, you could almost predict, and this is from 1980, that Diana would not have a very successful time. Okay.
Hi.
He's going to ask me for the history of the world now, aren't you?
No. No, actually I was going to ask you for a little bit of the history of the princes, the Council of Princes. Mm-hmm. You talked quite a bit about bringing the bloodline to date. And here in this school we make a distinction between the physical body and the bloodline and its genetic potential and who's occupying it.
Right. Okay. The route to kingship comes from only one source. The route to kingship is only messiahship, dragonship. The sovereign earthling line of monarchy is the line that we talked about today. Now, this line, of course, has spread its branches throughout history and become all sorts of royal and noble houses, some of whom from time to time have held crowns and thrones in Europe, and many who never have. The interesting thing is that whenever one is looking at key aspects of this line, whether you're looking at the Merovingians in France or the Royal House of Stuart in Scotland for that matter, these families eventually get knocked out of position by the church or the other parliamentary establishments because they follow a Grail code rule of the monarch is there to serve the people. Whereas in fact, the rule actually is the monarch is there to serve the church and the church-controlled parliament. So it hasn't had the greatest success in history as reigning monarchs, but it has had an amazing success in history as princes in the background, and certainly as monarchs when they get the chance to be monarchs for a while. The European Council of Princes is comprised not only of princes of that particular bloodline or the particular strains of it, but of some offshoot branches of it as well. And remember, they weren't all there in the 15 and 16 and 1700s taking starfire. Those days were long gone. So the families had become very much like ordinary people. It's just that from time to time, it is very apparent when you've got a very clean route in the line, because the stories in that line, and this is where Diana comes from, whether they're out of royalty or in royalty, their tradition, and it's generally in a female line rather than a male line, it's a very strong one, a very powerful one when it comes to serving people. These are true Grail queens. What I love about the Diana story is that she's actually now become the Lady of the Lake because where they buried her. The Council of Princes was founded in 1946, immediately after the war, and it comprised, with the exception of the House of Windsor, every royal house in Europe. There are now other royal families coming in. The House of Romanov, Russian House, is just joining now. The House of Napoleon is coming on board now. So there are other lines that aren't necessarily bloodline royalty that are coming on board with the Council of Princes. Its money was achieved originally from here, America, in 1946. And with Grand Duke Otto of Austria, von Habsburg, as its president, it sat as a committee with the objective of constraining either further rise of Nazi-type regimes in the West or of restraining the rise of communism in the West. And America funded this, and the Council of Princes became that institution. They were at that time actually called the International Council of Government. So if you look into the US Senate archives and see the International Council of Government, that's who they are. However, they could only operate on one basis, and the basis was simply this, and the Americans understood it, because the Americans said, what you have to do to make sure that these things don't take place in your country is to become champions of your country's individual written constitutions. To uphold those constitutions, not to uphold your aristocracies and parliament, and to say whenever a parliament or the church or the aristocracy want to do something that impinges upon the rights, liberties, freedoms and welfare of the people, sorry, you can't do that, the constitution says so. Now they have done that very successfully since 1946 in every country except Britain, and the House of Windsor have declined every year to join the council because we do not have a written constitution. We're the only country in the civilized Western world that does not. Why? Because just like George I couldn't speak English or write English, we are a parliamentary controlled society, and that is where it will remain until somebody changes the monarchical system in Britain and gives us a written constitution. And most of my work, apart from talking about my books, is done in the political field, talking about the importance of written constitutions, particularly in Britain, and the rewriting of some of the European runs to bring them up to date. Britain does not have a written constitution. Britain is in the European Union with other countries. The International Council of Government had to change its name when the European Parliament came about because there seemed to be a sort of a conflict. So suddenly, the people of these countries became aware of who was behind this International Council of Government, because they didn't actually know it was the sons and the daughters of royal houses, be they ruling houses or not. And it became the European Council of Princes in 1992. And that was exactly the year that I was taken on board as the presidential attaché to the council. It was actually because of my presidential attaché to the council that I got access to archives that other people wouldn't have and was able to write Bloodline of the Holy Grail, because these are the archives that give us the messianic line all the way back, all the way back to Jesus. So, who are they, what are they? They are royal houses who may be of or may not be of the direct royal bloodline, who uphold and champion written constitutions on behalf of the people of those countries, in a nutshell.
Short.
Hello, you have to jump up to that one. How are we doing for time? One more?
Thank you.
This will have to be the last one. I'm told we're running on a bit. Okay. Beddy by his time.
Did you find an impetus that caused the Egyptians to seek another source of the star fire rather than keep on using the ritual of the scarlet women?
Yeah.
And two part. Were they both men and women that then became these alchemists that used the gold, and did women ever consume the starfire?
Yeah. The reason that the Egyptians had the priestess scarlet women in the first place was because they were never involved in the original Anunnaki starfire practice. They inherited the custom in Egypt and had to create a vehicle for it, and this vehicle became these priestesses. These were highly bred people, and again, I suspect that they lived particularly constrained lifestyles and had special diets and whatever, so that they were as good as they could be. But ultimately, what they were was very high specimens of the human race. They weren't actually Anunnaki. So in effect, although the starfire ritual was being played out, and in fact the starfire ritual gave the kingly line the route to the starfire, the extract from menstrual blood, whatever it was they did, what they were actually doing was getting a little bit of a hormone boost, but that was it. I mean, it wasn't doing anything magnificently, so they were just getting a bit of a hormone boost. What happened was that it seemed far more sensible to forget the ritual. And this is what's so interesting about this, because even in those days, they understood that times change, things change. Sometimes you have to think again, and the old dogmas and customs must go. Unfortunately, for 3,000 or 4,000 years since that, the church has not learned this lesson. But at that moment in time, they knew it, and they said, okay, that was yesterday's history, but at least we've learned the production of these hormones does amazing things for people. What we need is a way of making people make more of these hormones for themselves. We need something that will actually shunt those glands into action and make them produce more stuff. Now, this was produced out of very expensive substances. We're talking about platinums and golds and things, so it wasn't exactly something for everybody. This was for the kingly line. So they didn't exactly sacrifice it for something less. They sacrificed it for something better. I've forgotten the second part of your question. It was so long ago.
Did women also, were they also?
Oh, yeah, that's right. I guess so. The theory behind it was that the importance of the gene moved through the female line. In essence, they were talking about mitochondrial DNA, which is an inheritance, in fact, not just through the female line, but moves from mother to daughter, which is an interesting one. Which is why it was kind of important to marry your sister, but more important to marry a sister who was a daughter of your mother than it was to marry a daughter of your father. So you find that a lot of the Egyptian pharaohs in particular married sisters, daughters of their mother, but not necessarily of their father, the pharaoh. So that, in fact, that was where the line came in and created the next pharaoh from, but then there had to be from that mother another daughter by a different father. So they're always marrying half-sisters, not full sisters. But yes, they would have been fed it. They would have had it because they were really the key to it. It would have been essential that they were in as heightened a physical capacity as possible. Yeah. Okay. That seems to be about it. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks a lot.